County Commissioners Work Session for Tuesday, August 16th. And let's see, it's about 1 o'clock, a little after 1, and we're going to start with the 2016-2017 Renewable Energy Mitigation Program, known as REMP, funding discussion, including the 2016 Randy Udall Energy Pioneer Grants for the upcoming year and core programs. And we have an hour for this discussion. So let's introduce yourselves and take it away, please.
I'm Cindy Hubin with Community Development.
And I'm Mona Newton, I'm the core director.
And I'm Marty Treadway, and I'm the core grants director.
Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you very much for allowing us to come before you today. And first of all, I need to apologize. I put the wrong date on the work session memo. It said August 16, 2015, and we're in 2016.
You caught it. I didn't
even notice that.
I know. See, nobody. I caught it last week after I sent it. I'm like, anyway. But so we're here to just give you an update on where we're at with our program funding requests for the coming year. So I'm going to just give you a little bit of background on REMP. Mainly, I know it's for the TV viewing audience than for you all because you've gone through this. This is my fifth time, and so I'm sure it must be your more than that time. What are the funds, what can we use the funds for? I want to tell you a little bit about our program progress and then our 2016-2017 proposed request. So as you know, in 1999, the City of Aspen and Pitkin County adopted REMP into the building code, and REMP is designed to offset energy and environmental impacts and greenhouse gas emissions from new homes larger than 5,000 square feet, and then the exterior energy use from snowmelt, hot tubs, pools, and spas. And pools and spas are probably the same thing. And they have two ways that they can mitigate their energy use. They can offset the renewable energy use on site, or they can pay into the REMP fund. And as you know, we did a study last year on how the funds are or how those that have to comply with REMP are doing. And again, we have about 43% who mitigate on site and 75% mitigate somewhat on site, and then the rest pay into the REMP fund. And in 2009, this policy was expanded to include our commercial projects. And as you also know, we've been part of work sessions where Brian Paul has come before you to discuss some updates to the building code and the formula calculations for REMP. But what I'm talking about is where we're currently at. So code has established a formula for calculating the energy mitigation requirements. And as I said, they can mitigate on site or they can pay the fee in lieu of mitigation. The city and the county collect those funds into the REMP fund, and then CORE, as stipulated by the resolution, is administering those programs, and we're required to develop programs that will mitigate at least two times or more the CO2 offset that gets paid for. So we're able to spend those funds in Aspen and Pitkin County and the Roaring Fork Valley, and these are used to contribute to a more sustainable economy. The priorities for REMP include affordable housing and public buildings, the residential sector, so that we can do renewable energy and energy efficiency. It also can be used with the commercial sector for innovative technologies and supporting the local workforce. And I think we've been able to accomplish all of those over the years with the REMP funds. So what we do is CORE staff will develop those funding proposals. We present them before the CORE board of trustees, and then the CORE board approves them, and then we come to you, and then we go to the city council for approval. Originally, about 29% of the funds could be spent, so there's a principal that gets preserved every year, and now we're allowed to spend up to 30% of those funds. And that's a CORE board policy. It's not necessarily a county or a city policy, but it's a CORE board policy. And the idea is to, in the event that we have another great recession again, that we can continue the programs, because it's important to maintain consistency with energy efficiency and renewable energy programs for the public, because, you know, you think you're going to implement a an insulation program and you're expecting to get a rebate, and if the money's not there or the rebates aren't available, you may not do the program. And so consistency is real important with energy efficiency programs. I'm going to turn it over to Marty. This is his first year as our grants manager, so he took over when Jason left last year, even though Marty's been with us for some time. So,
and just to clarify, the goal today of the meeting would be to brief all these, ask and answer our questions, and then it will be forwarded on for approval by the city and the county at our separate regular meetings.
Yes, thank you. Okay. Yeah, we have a resolution.
So, did any of the board members have any questions so far on the goals and the outlined priorities? Okay, let's go on.
So I'm Marty Treadway. I'm the grants manager with CORE, and I'm here mostly to talk about the grants program today and some of CORE's other programs as well. But the top of the grants list is the Randy Udall Energy Pioneer Grant. That's obviously the large program that we run every year. It's usually typically around $500,000 worth of REMP funds that go to fund a large energy saving project and carbon reduction projects in the valley. So this is Carbondale to Aspen focused. And so some examples of these in previous years have been the Mountain Rescue Solar PV and Solar Thermal Project in 2013. The community church had a boiler replacement and a hot water heater, indirect hot water heater upgrade. And also the library building that we're in here today. We help support that project with energy efficiency upgrades and some ongoing monitoring that is almost completed, I understand. So electric side is up and running and we're still waiting on the gas side. But some pretty exciting projects and visionary projects, hopefully. A main goal of this program is to really inspire and new out-of-the-box thinking and share those ideas with other entities in the valley so that they can take advantage of some of the lessons learned. Similar project in Basalt RMI with their net zero building down there, we help support that as well. So those are some of the examples. We also have the Community Grants Program, which is a bread and butter grants program at CORE. These are up to $10,000 individual grants for individuals or businesses or nonprofits who are looking to save energy on some of the smaller projects. We've done a lot of LED relamping projects, for example. You know, these are boiler upgrades. These are the meat and potatoes kind of projects that may not inspire the big Randy Udall grant, but they're ongoing all the time, and so we try to support those as much as possible. The Community Grants Program has already almost this year reached the funding level of the previous year, so we're expecting large growth in that program, probably in the neighborhood of 25-30% growth there. The Energy Design Assistance Grants, similar to Community Grants, they're smaller, $0 to $20,000, but say your institution wants to do something innovative like Habitat for Humanity, but they don't know how to go about it and they need some design assistance. So we help pay for that through commissioning entities like SGM or REG over in Crested Butte, and they can do some design analysis and see if it's worth it to do the heat pump system versus the gas boiler system, for example. And they'll run the numbers on that, and then if it's compelling, they may come to us for a Udall grant to actually fund the work. So that's the idea of the design assistance grants. We've done two of those this year. Typically, we'll probably do another one, 2 to 3 of those per year is what we've been doing. So we've already done those two, so that program is also really engaged right now and probably seeing a little bit of growth. Energy Smart Colorado, the next program down on the list here, in size, second only to the grants as far as the budget request. It's a large program. It includes really all of the residential energy efficiency and renewable energy support that CORE offers to the valley. So these are rebates. These are your solar PV rebates, your solar thermal rebates, and the energy advising that goes along with those, and also residential and commercial energy assessments. So the residential assessments have a cost associated with them. CORE helps to support some of those expenses, so homeowners only have to pay $100 instead of, you know, $300 or $400 for these assessments. So we leverage utility funding to get that number down. CORE doesn't subsidize all of that, but part of the program is to engage local utilities in that program and help buy down the cost of all of these services, so assessments, advising, and rebates. We bring that all together with a centralized database that we help to develop with our other partners in the region. And so most of you are aware that this all started with the RF funds grants from Eagle, Pickin, and Gunnison counties, and so that we continue to leverage the tools that were built during that time. Next up, we have the the REACH Income Qualified Program, another leverage program. We had been doing REACH on our own for a couple of years, and through Energy Smart Colorado, had the opportunity to expand this partnership with Energy Outreach Colorado, who does income qualified programs throughout the state. And so this past year, we partnered with them on what they call their CARE program. And so Energy Smart Colorado and CARE are the partners in this valley to bring income qualified programs to those people in need. And we plan to continue that program through next year with matching funds from Energy Outreach Colorado. That's been very successful. Mona told me this morning we've reached 43 households so far in 2016 that met that 80% AMI income qualification.
Patty? Yeah, I have a question. How does this work with, or does it work with, Northwest COG's weatherization program?
That is a great question. right now, there's sort of parallel programs. Northwest COG is a little deeper on the retrofit side, and we're a little deeper on the analysis side and the rebate side. And so some of those participants, we do send them to COG if it makes sense. COG right now has a waiting list in Pickin County, and so that can be very lengthy. And so we try and serve those customers as best we can without COG if it makes sense. But we just had a team call yesterday where we brought this up with some of our other partners, and we are going to be actively engaging COG on how we can help partner a little bit better than we have been, so it's not an all or nothing. Mm-hmm. We can sort of pool both programs of both resources and pick and choose what makes sense for each customer. So,
because in the past we weren't able to really reach those income levels in Pickin County, so obviously things have changed. And if you need any help, I'm in the COG rep for the board, so if you need any help, let me know, because I do regularly attend the COG meetings.
And that's great. Thanks, Patty. The other piece is that our program serves a higher income
right.
than the Northwest COG program does. So Marty talked about that income level. Theirs is 200% of poverty level. It's hard to translate these numbers, but and ours is at 80% of poverty level. I just did a calculation yesterday. So for an example, a family of eight, you can make up to $100,000 in Pickin County, whereas it would probably be half of that or maybe three quarters of that to qualify for the Northwest COG
right.
program.
So this is a great way to fill those gaps, I think, and partnering and teamwork is probably perfect. So just let me know if there's anything I can do to help.
Yeah,
thank you.
Great.
Patty does a great job with COG, and that was an issue that came up before. How much are we really getting back out of this program? It also strikes me that perhaps talking with our Health and Human Services would be valuable in terms of them. I know there's privacy laws and how to get the word out has to be done very cautiously, but yet they're qualifying people for either child care assistance at those sort of poverty levels or other programs. And so, I don't know if there's a sign up in their office where they're really doing people, and just because to me it's similar to the Kids First program in Aspen that goes down to a certain level for child care support, and then the city's CCAP program, the county CCAP program, does the lowest end, and the more they mesh together, the better. That's a great point, Patty.
Well, and just Nan Sundin actually was our inspiration for the program before we started a partnership with CARE a few years ago. We do reach out to them at least once a year when we start the program, but what's nice about the partnership with CARE is that we had kind of a startup and shut down. Now, with partnering with CARE, I think we can run it year-round, and you know, sometimes deadlines, people miss them and they get confused, and so now this enables us to run a year-round program, and I think we'll be able to strengthen those partnerships with the funding, with the organizations that support the same target income levels that we're going after.
Great, thank you very much.
And just to close on that REACH program, so our other partners in the neighboring counties have some similar agreements with Energy Outreach Colorado as a result of this Energy Smart partnership. So Eagle and Summit and Lake and Garfield are part of this partnership as well, each with their own separate contracts with Energy Outreach Colorado to bring these programs. So it's really been a fun partnership. The next program here is the Net Zero Energy Grants, and we started these just this past year as an incentive program to get new construction down to zero energy. And we dedicated $80,000 to that program this year in the hopes of serving 10 homeowners. And we have already signed up 10 projects for this program. We are still going to take applications through the end of the year in the hopes that, well, in the expectation that not everyone will hit the full funding amount. So it's a sliding grant. We didn't put it up here, but from $2,000 if you beat code to $8,000 if you hit zero. So it's a very aggressive program to help offset some of the expenses of building a net zero energy home. And it's been very successful so far this year, so we'd like to continue that. And then I don't know if you want to do program delivery.
Yeah, so then program delivery is one of our efforts. It's that we're requesting funding for this year. And that really speaks to all of the work that we do to implement the programs. And that's everything from assigning the assessments and reviewing them and then going back to the homeowner and asking them how we can help them develop a plan. It's processing our rebates, it's tracking our data. We work with grantees, you know, before they apply for grants and once they receive a grant. It's, as you know, we are working with APCHA this year to upgrade several affordable housing complexes. It's implementing the REACH program that takes quite a bit of time because we really work with those clients. And this year we've made a lot more effort in the Spanish, the Latino community outreach, or the Spanish-speaking population. So, and we've gotten 3 or 4 applicants, which doesn't sound like a lot, but if that's 10% of our total, that's better than what we hit last year. So we're pretty excited about that. And it's our technical support that we provide to our communities, whether it's on building codes. We're trying to get all communities up to 2015 this year, and we're working with the green teams on that. And then we're doing carbon emissions inventories. We're working with Pitkin County. We almost completed the Pitkin County inventory, and that'll help set goals. That's, I think, one of your goals for this year as well. So we've been working on that. And we're working with the town of Basalt and Snowmass to update their emissions inventory. And then it helps us with our community grants, our energy design assistance grants. And then we potentially would take on some new projects this year that would include CPACE. And then one idea that came out of the CORE board strategic planning session this year is a bulk purchase program for EVs and PVs, which was pretty successful in Boulder County. So just want to give you some of our program results from over the last couple years. Last week, I think I handed out our annual report. I don't know if you had a chance to read that cover to cover, but anyway, we've had pretty tremendous growth from 2014 to 2015. We've seen double-digit increase in home energy assessments. We've done 13% more in 2015 over 2015. We've done issued 33% more rebates on the residential side over 2014. And the commercial sector has also grown double digits, 16%. And as I mentioned, the REACH participants, we went from 26 in 2015, and now we'll be doing 40 in 2016. So we're seeing quite a bit of growth. And we added the Net Zero Grant Program last year. As Marty just said, we have 10 approved applicants. We have design assistance grants that the growth is increasing there, and community grants as well. So we've already committed two times more in 2016 over 2015. So overall, our programs are continuing to grow, which is great. That's what we need in order to reduce carbon, save money, help our economy, all the measures that we track ourselves against. So Marty's going to go over, so as he's mentioned, one of our biggest programs is the True Grant program funding. We usually allocate about $500,000 in our budget for that. And he's going to go over the applications we received and what the Citizens Grant Committee and then the CORE Board recommends for funding.
Okay. Any board questions or comments at this point? Please continue.
Okay. So the 2016 True Grant applicants, you have the list in front of you here. These are listed in alphabetical order, with the batch up top being the ones that were not recommended for funding, and the batch in the bottom that were recommended for funding alphabetically in each. This year, the board designated a $525,000 budget. You'll see that the current recommendations from the review committee are a total $498,500. So Anderson Ranch Center, they were previous UDOL grant recipients. They had a small request for an LED retrofit, and the review committee decided that could be a community grant. It didn't need to go through this process, and CORE staff had supported that idea as well. The Aspen Historical Society was not recommended for funding. It was a $150,000 request for lighting, heating system, fuel switch, and some pretty innovative things that the review committee did want to support, but it's just with funding being limited, it didn't make the final cut. But there was a lot of interest in this project. It just wasn't recommended for funding this year. We are talking with them about community grant opportunities or reapplying for next year as well. The Rio Grande Parking Plaza lighting retrofit similarly was recommended for a community grant. It's a smaller request, so was not recommended for UDOL funds. The Colorado Rocky Mountain School is retrofitting a dorm that's on their campus in Carbondale. Small dorm, but there's two staff housing units in there, so it was pretty compelling to consider that for a grant, a little bit of affordable housing component. It was a $125,000 request, so it ended up not being recommended for funding, but again, we are talking with them about some other opportunities with our other grant programs. The Children's Rocky Mountain School, full LED and insulation work. They are retrofitting a unit downtown in Carbondale off of Main Street. And so that was a $23,000 request that was not recommended for funding. But CORE staff is interested in supporting them with a community grant if possible. So we're looking at that now. Grid Alternatives, an interesting one. They had a previous UDOL grant that was approved a couple years ago in the same amount, $25,000, but it was for individual solar, rooftop solar systems for income qualified participants. And they are now this year requesting a community solar model for income qualified customers.
That'll be built in Roy.
Yes, so the recommendation was made to keep it off of this year's budget. The review committee just decided that it would be best for us to renew their two-year-old grant, since that money has not been spent yet, and add the strings that this community solar project must be built in the Roaring Fork Valley. That was true of their old grant. It will now be true of this grant. So it's just from individual to community solar. So we didn't feel like that was needing any board action there.
Yeah. And
the CORE board.
Let's digress for a second, because I was actually going to ask that question. Whether it's this year's recipients or past year's recipients, what is the tracking on the implementation of the grants and the checkbacks? And you really kind of answered the question I first had, which was, if they've applied for a previous grant, do we know what they've done with the last one before they're even considered? So why don't you just elaborate on the tracking of the utilization of these for a moment?
Sure. That's a great point. So we have a pretty robust database that keeps track of every one of these projects, whether it's a light bulb or whether it's, you know, Habitat for Humanity solar project. So that might be the best example. Habitat has applied this year for funding again, and you'll see them next on the list. They still have a grant that's not completed from last year that was for PV. And so we know exactly where they're at in that stage. We know they haven't started their building yet, so obviously the PV is not installed yet. They have 2 years to complete that scope of work. and then apply for a third-year extension with us if needed. So some of these grants will roll over year to year, and some of these entities you will see coming back to you again and again because they're doing a lot of innovative work. So that's your Habitats, that's your Pickens Counties, that's your Town of Snowmass Village. So they may, there may be overlap. We don't ever allow them to overlap on the scope of work. Mm-hmm. And so each one of these grants is tied to a specific scope of work that you all will approve if it's approved. And so that's documented and we track that.
And Marty, it's my understanding we don't give the money until the project's complete.
Correct. So
it's more of a reimbursement program.
Exactly. Must be fully completed, must have final invoices. We have, some of these have multiple scopes, and so if there's a cash flow issue, they can apply for the LED money, a portion of their grant, if they've completed a portion of their work. So we've done that in the past. Our rule is it's got to be fully completed, and we write one check. Okay. So
great.
Makes
thank
it
you
easier
for
on everybody.
That information. We'll continue with the list.
Okay.
And then, like, just to add, so on PV systems, you've all requested, how do we know that they're performing? They're still working. So we started requiring, as of 2 years ago, monitoring systems and for solar thermal and solar PV systems as well. So
thank you.
Okay, so continuing along the list, starting to get into the ones that were recommended for funding for 2016, starting with Habitat for Humanity, Roaring Fork. And this is the same entity that has the PV grant open, as I mentioned. But as they started getting construction documents completed and some value engineering questions came up, they really started looking at envelope improvements this spring to reduce their operating costs. They're looking to reduce their heating equipment size and trying to develop as tight an envelope as possible with a porous steel building. And so we've been heavily engaged with Green Line Architects in Carbondale and SGM on this grant request to improve that steel building and sort of create a new paradigm for steel buildings in the local region. So this one's a pretty exciting one. The Citizens Review Committee recommended full funding at $125,000 for that project.
So this project is for their expansion of their existing building that's by the old restaurant, whatever that, the motorcycle shop is in Habitat.
That's right.
Because I just talked to somebody and I didn't realize that they were gifted or purchased at some cost more land there. So they're just going to expand there.
That's right. It's right next to the existing site.
Perfect. Okay.
They got a USDA grant.
Is that what they got? Oh, great. Oh, good for them.
So the next three grants here are all Pickens County, two solar and one new building. So Pickens County Landfill requested 102 kilowatt PV system on site. We've been talking with the landfill for several years about trying to do some PV up there to create some solar production right here in the Aspen area, which is pretty exciting. That was also recommended at full funding at $132,005. And similarly, Pickens County Public Works submitted a request for 90 kilowatt PV. Both of these would reach nearly 100% offset of electrical use at both sites. So that's really exciting. That was recommended for funding at 50%, so roughly, so $55,000 was recommended for that project. Next is Pickens County Sheriff's, the remodel.
One more question,
yes?
Though, on that, and this is a little more for John Peacock. As we were starting to look at that, we have the solar analysis and study that we've seen prior, and then we made a separate decision to buy into the solar farm. Or are we still moving forward with these two items at the landfill as well? Or are we?
Well, and so that's going to be a conversation with that for the board. I think the direction that we took from the presentation that we had was to go ahead and pursue the alternatives at the public work site in the landfill because of their payback period. You know, it was a reasonable payback period. The solar farm purchase came at us as another opportunity, and so we viewed them as separate, but obviously that's going to be a final decision for the board.
Okay, I just want to kind of clarify that because it does make sense in that they're for different facilities that the community has through the county. Okay, thank you. Sorry. And Michael, that was a question.
So, you know, we did have that discussion about those projects. And it was really phrased in terms of which two projects do you think are best for the county?
Mm-hmm.
And so we narrowed it down to the solar farm, because we thought that was the best alternative. So, but we weren't told there was a parallel track of seeking funding for those projects at the landfill and at the public works. So I don't quite understand what's going on.
So the direction that, sorry, the direction that we thought we had was to pursue funding opportunities and development of the projects that were deemed most feasible. The challenge with the solar farm at the landfill was that there was not a specific site that didn't conflict with operations. So we were still wrestling with those alternatives when we brought those forward. We have taken the board's direction to continue to look at, you know, is there a solar farm opportunity at the landfill that would not have operating conflicts, but that we believed, we understood from the board that where we had 100% offset and the shorter payback periods by developing solar on site, which is the rooftop solar at Public Works, as well as I believe it's on top of the MRF facility at the landfill, that the board wanted us to look at implementation and financing strategies. Those, even with these grant funds aligned, the board would still need to appropriate those funds and approve the projects for implementation finally. So we have been continuing to pursue financing options, including grants and such, to see how we could pay for those solar facilities. That is in addition to the CEC contract, which the advantage of that is we are not able to offset solar necessarily into the grid in the upper valley, so we have a limited number of facilities that we're able to put solar on. We determined that our new project at the courthouse would not be viable for a solar option, but the CEC contract seemed to be an opportunity to provide some of that offset, even though it's on a different grid. Does that?
Well, I don't remember. I thought at the time it was a choice between those projects at Public Works and at the landfill, or the solar farm. And so we chose the solar farm. I didn't realize we'd left the door open to seek other funding.
See, and we didn't understand it as the board not supporting. We understood that the board supported the most feasible options, which was the public work site and the MRF facility, and wanted us to continue to look into opportunities for a solar farm, whether that be at the landfill or the option that we finally landed on was CEC. We understood it as a yes and. We should be looking at both of those opportunities.
Yeah.
I don't recall that, John.
I recall it similar to as John is saying, in that we saw buying into the existing solar farm as something that could come online very immediately and have, again, some different contractual relationships about how it feeds into the grid. I would just note that, similar to any of these other grant applications, we have 2 years to implement the project and to kind of come back to the board and more fully vet as needed this, but getting the funding lined up so that the opportunity there is important. Now, I'll be the first to say we don't want to be a placeholder if we're not moving it forward, but I think there was a lot of interest through the various different sites that the county has to potentially offset our new building as well as Public Works and landfill. George has a comment.
just to further complicate this, I was going to wait, but since we're into this discussion, and this bonus sort of brought this to my attention after the board, core board met, and because when we met as a core board, one of the things we were discussing was looking at how to really go after some big projects, and so we thought about what are the sort of the future projects where we can really see some great gain in terms of reducing our carbon footprint and saving dollars. And so we mentioned the hospital, we mentioned the airport, and we for whatever reason, it didn't really escape us, but next on the list is our new public safety and administrative building. So here's a brand new building of how large?
We're adding approximately 18,000 square
feet. About 18,000, that's going to be a public building. It's going to be a showcase. And so we thought, well, maybe there's a better better reallocation of the dollars that are currently before us to put more dollars into the new building and get the biggest bang for our buck. And we asked staff to contact Jody to sort of see what the difference would buy us. So right now you'll see that the grant given to the public safety building is $43,000. So what does that $43,000 buy us versus using the monies that have been granted for the public works and the landfill solar, which it comes out to around $230,000. What does that buy us? Is that buy us something that's really going to make a huge difference in terms of being able to take advantage of a brand new building from ground up? And then we can always, in a year or two, we can always come back and reapply for these other solar grants. So that's a discussion that I was going to bring up as part of this proposal. And I was going to have Marty, if you had a chance to talk to Jody, to see what the difference is between the $43,000 that we've already currently got versus the $230,000. And it's not a decision we'd have to make right now because this is just a work session. We would want to perhaps just have this as an option. I think we'd want to come back to the core board to discuss this because the core board has already approved this list to see if they're comfortable for reallocation. So that just sort of adds to this conversation.
So obviously we're going to need another work session, I think, to address both of the concerns that have been raised. We aren't obviously prepared to address those in full today. What I would say regarding the new building versus solar, there's really two different strategies. One strategy is a conservation. How do we build our building so that it uses less energy? And then the other strategy is how do you produce energy in a renewable way to feed into the grid. And for our building up here, the strategy really is around conservation measures. How do we reduce our per square foot energy consumption? Because the production side isn't really seen as a viable solution for several reasons. And we had talked about that, the board had talked about that when we were talking about the energy conservation measures for the building and what we might pursue and might not pursue. And we set a per square foot energy goal. And so the design team right now in the county is committed to that per square foot energy goal that the board gave us, and we're working towards that. So we're adopting conservation solutions, you know, whether that be actually insulating the building as a low-hanging fruit one, as well as the types of mechanical the type of mechanical plant that we put in for heating, cooling, and those sorts of things, which is really what we're applying for in this grant round, is to support those design elements. How much more we could really achieve by adding dollars to that, we can certainly have that conversation with Jody and our design team, but we think we're going to be hard pressed, George, to go much below that per square foot consumption budget. even throwing more measures at it right now without the ability to actually produce. And so that is where we're looking at, you know, the either the solar farm alternatives or those sorts of things to actually have some offset with renewables. Seems to me we probably, if this is a conversation, particularly if it's going to affect the design of the building, we've got to have that like next week, because we're getting too far along to redesign the building for any additional measures.
Well, I guess then, thanks for the clarification. I guess yeah. My question is then the grant that Jody had put in for the true grant of $306,000, that was to basically address what's already been engineered and planned.
Correct. We've been aggressive. We feel like if we are able to achieve that per square foot number on energy consumption, we will be one of the most efficient buildings in the Grand Valley. So we've set a very aggressive energy budget, and we are aggressively pursuing technologies, and we've asked for support to help us do that, because it does increase the cost of the building. We're going to try and find a way to do those. Where the discussion may go, George, is what may have to be value engineered out of the building and other areas to achieve that energy budget if we're not able to raise other financing mechanisms.
Okay, great. And then back to my original point in terms of we could have a conversation in terms of reallocating the grant dollars that have been allocated for the landfill and for the public works, and use them for the new building to make sure that we don't have to do any more value engineering.
That's correct.
And then put off the solar on these other properties down the road.
Yes.
And that reflects the conversation that I had with Jody and her team yesterday as well.
Yeah. Okay. So that helps.
Sorry, it took so long.
No, that's fine.
So.
It's a little confusing for
so
sure.
So that's something as we finish the questions and Marty goes through the rest of the list, we could have a board discussion to see what recommendations the board would have. Mona is meeting with the city council on Monday with the same. If we wanted to go in that direction, she would have to have that sort of as a caveat, and then we would discuss this as a core board next Thursday as well.
And I think it may be worth, to Michael's point, if staff has misunderstood the direction on solar, it would benefit us to know that now too, both for consideration of the core grants and where those funds should go, and how we're asking GR to spend his time. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay, Stephen and Patty.
I don't recall exactly what we decided when we were having that presentation, but those two projects are really the easy, quick and easy, low-hanging fruit. They provide, you know, the net metering, it provides about 100% of the electric use at those facilities. Likewise, the buying into the solar farm, that is providing the offset for the snow melt at the ABC underpass. So all three of those projects are earmarked for specific facilities on the net metering, and it's most efficient. You know, you don't have any loss of electricity if you're producing the electricity right there. Now, I would love to do a big community solar farm where we could offset electricity for the airport and the Health and Human Services building and our new facility here. It's a much more complicated project that maybe involves different electric utilities and different political entities, and it's going to take a lot longer time to put that together. These we can do really quickly, and relatively quickly
in a government scheme of things. Yeah.
So I'm in favor of proceeding with these two projects right here.
Thank you, Patty.
Yeah, I do remember us when we had our solar discussion talking about the solar farm for the offsetting, like Steve said, of the underpass, and that we should be looking at. We didn't actually say core grants. We said look at funding opportunities or other opportunities to pursue these other or some other form of solar project that the county could do. So I don't have a problem with them being in this. Georgia's thought just is something new to me, and I think really deserves discussion. I think it's a great idea. I think that being able, from my past experience from many years with CORE, being able to start with a new building and making it the best you can saves you dollars, and you have a really much better outcome, I think. And I would really like to look at pursuing what Georgia's mentioned here. I think if we can do that, I think that would be a really key part of this discussion of these grants.
John?
I just add, I think, one more piece of context, because I think what's going to be really important for staff to bring back to the table is our latest construction estimates. And right now, FCI is working on off of our plans that we submitted for permit. We expect to have that construction estimate back with bids and such on subs in about 4 weeks, and so we'll have a better idea, George, at that point. Are we in a value engineering kind of circumstance where we're asking the types of questions that I think you're concerned about, or has our budget held up, and are we, with the grant as it stands today, able to pursue the project without that? I don't know how that works with CORE's timeline, but that would, to address the question that I think I heard hear the board getting at, I think it's important for us to have those construction estimates really back and firmed up, so we know what kind of question we're really asking, and are the grant dollars really going towards energy conservation at that point?
And I think Mona could respond to this better than I can, but I think what we could do is we could, as we finish through this list, if the list looks fine in general in terms of the dollars allocated in the projects, we could say, well, let's be a little flexible in terms of the grants to Pickens County and see, exactly, once we get this further information, whether we should reallocate or not, as long as the city agrees and certainly the
move it forward in that manner,
sells, buys off on that.
So we could redraft the resolution. And looking at it, I hadn't added up all the numbers. It's quite a chunk of change there for the county, $220,000.
230, yeah.
And say we could allocate that towards those three projects and then determine where the best uses go towards. And we could then, right,
with a clear explanation given to the city, so they understood the time frame that we're in and our desire to do the best thing with those dollars.
Right, mm-hmm. And I think they would understand, as you know, they've been under discussion about a new city building as well. So
we hope that they would understand.
Yes, and if I could just address to John the question of the budgets. Jody's team yesterday afternoon indicated that they are still on track with the budget as it was when they made this application. So they are still planning on the building design as is, but they're still about $300,000 short. And this grant was going to be one of the ways they met that gap.
And that is true. And I think we'll have better information in 4 weeks as far as where those numbers really sit.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think we got a good understanding of where that's going now. And thanks, George and Patty and Steve, everyone, Michael, for bringing this up and taking a hard look at it. And we'll continue to sort it out as we go forward. And John, you'll work this into our future agendas in a timely fashion.
So do you want us to bring back the solar question then, is just so I'm clear?
I think the more the construction budget and the new building, and then how different aspects would integrate into that.
Okay.
From there.
And might I add that one of the projects, the Public Works building offset, it was only allocated roughly a little less than half of the project. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering if, in fact, that could even go forward in our budget, the county's budget, without that additional funding this next year, and whether or not that's kind of the sweet spot, if you will, for where that money is for this next year or the next 2 years that might be allocated
on the interim
building. Yeah.
And so, if I might add, the next item up on your agenda is CPACE, and should the county decide to opt into that, that could be a potential financing mechanism for future public projects. So,
Steve, really briefly, and then we'll get back on track here a little bit.
Just a comment. I saw recently Eagle County, I think, now provides the offsetting electricity for about 55% of all of their facilities, the county facilities in Eagle County. And they've been really aggressive in purchasing things in the community solar farms and various, they're taking advantage of the opportunities. And we're like dabbling our little toe in just barely compared to what our neighbor has already done. So I'd like to look at bold solutions too, and really, you know, it's an opportunity to move ahead of.
Okay, thank you, Steve. Please continue. And just as a time check, I know we started a little late. It is now 2 o'clock, and we have a half hour scheduled for the property assessed clean energy program. So let's try to finish this item first and move on.
Okay, great. In the interest of time, I'll lump these next two together. Tanos Nomas Village, Brush Creek, and Palisades are both employee housing units up there in the village, and they are doing major energy retrofits of their envelopes and controls and lighting systems. And so both of those entities asked for $100,000 each, and it was recommended that they would each get funding at half of that, $50,000 apiece. Two Rivers Community School in Glenwood Springs. This is one that was very innovative. They were asking for a grant to do a rooftop classroom, which the review committee really liked the idea, but there was almost no energy savings component to that. It was a very inspiring project that they are recommending we go back to them for some clarity and some energy component for next year. So they chose, out of the $200,000 that you see there that was requested, they chose to support a $20,000 grant specifically for one of the scopes of that request, which was solar tubes, which is daylighting for interior spaces. Some of these classrooms are in an old postal warehouse down in Glenwood, and there's no outside light. And so this is a way to bring in outdoor light into a classroom space, which was a pretty innovative idea. So those are basically skylights, if you will, but they're a little more sophisticated than that, which will reduce lighting load in there. It's not a huge energy saver, but again, it's very innovative, and it's a great solution for those kids in those dark rooms. WeCycle is the final applicant here. They also have received previous funding for these WeCycle stations that you see all around the valley. They are expanding into the mid and lower valleys as well, and are requesting funding for solar charging for all of their stations to offset all of the battery charging that goes on for those bicycles. So pretty innovative request there at $75,000, and the committee recommended $23,000 for that scope. So the total there, $498,500. Again, the budget was $525,000 for the year, and that's what was recommended for funding.
Steve?
We skipped over the Pickin County Sheriff Facility Remodel.
Oh, sorry.
I thought we discussed that as part of the broader discussion.
Part of the all three.
I'm not sure if this has to do with PV. It sounds more like windows insulation or what?
Wasn't sure if I should dwell on that one or not. So Pickin County Sheriff, they requested $306,000 for that project. As you all know, this is the approved $24 million project, the new facility remodel. And it's very innovative building, and as John mentioned, it's a very low energy intensity design right now. And so the review committee wanted to support that project, but they only recommended $43,000 for funding for that, just dollars being what they are. So I think the conversation was about,
just for clarification, is this, it says remodel, which I take it to mean is in the courthouse, but does it mean the new facility?
Yeah, Steve. So the courthouse plaza is the remodel portion. So we have roughly 16,000 square feet there, including the basement space as well as the construction of the addition. And so our existing building is not very energy efficient per square foot. And so what we're looking for is the improvements that would be part of the remodel of that space to upgrade the mechanicals, insulation, windows, all of that, as well as the construction of the new space with those same energy conservation methods that we think are tried but also cutting edge.
I totally get that. I was thinking courthouse.
Oh, sorry, now it's Courthouse Plaza.
So that's why I was confused about it. Why are we putting money in there for the sheriff?
Yeah.
But I totally get this.
Yeah.
It doesn't look very exciting on the project description, but it actually is. The envelope and the heating system is very innovative, so.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
So the board, this is now the list to be forwarded to our regular meetings for adoption.
Yes.
And with the amendment, as it were, that we've described around the solar PV items with Pickens County, are there concerns or questions about the list going forward to formal adoption?
And this also includes the other programs supported by CORE and their administrative costs.
Right.
That's the whole group. No, I think we should move it forward with the caveat with the amendment for discussion with the city and further discussion by the BOCC.
Okay.
So we would come back to you with a we would submit a revised resolution, as I understand it.
I think revised resolution describing the landfill and public works option as we talked about before, to create a little flexibility for its use. And obviously, I think if it was repurposed, we would need to go back to the CORE board to affirm that they support that as well.
Right.
But that, at least in the, it's a little more of a heads up about that at this time.
Exactly. And so then we would go to the city and revise that resolution, and we'd come back to you with our total request of $2 million for all of our CORE, all of the programs that we presented, and the program delivery and administration funds.
Okay. Is that acceptable to the board? I see a nod of heads going forward. Okay. Very good. Now we'll move on to the next item, which is the Colorado Commercial Property Assessed Clean Energy Program. And, you know, I know we may not have the time for it today, but since the FAHA has come out with new guidance on residential PACE, and we already have bonding approval for residential PACE from many years ago before the recession, and Fannie Mae started holding off on that, we may not have time to get that tonight, but I really would like to have a future update on what the new guidance is on FHA on residential PACE and how we might begin to implement that.
Well, I can actually probably give you an update.
If we have enough time today, yeah, that'd be great.
What we're here today, and we have a resolution attached to this memo and an agreement, is to ask you, and I came before you in a work session, I think it was in February or March, to discuss CPACE, and that stands for the Commercial Property Assessed Clean Energy Program. And in that amount of time, we've had some cleanup legislation that was done to the legislation. John Ely has taken, he has reviewed the documents and provided comments back to the state, which the comment took into account and added them into the documents that we have forwarded before you. And so, again, it's a mechanism that helps finance energy and water conservation and renewable energy projects for up to 20 years, and they're repaid through the property assessments bill. So, for example, every year you receive a property assessment bill. If you are a commercial property owner, and I'm just going to single out Hunter Creek, then you could put in a solar system on that building, and it would be added to the annual property assessment.
But Hunter Creek is residential. Because it's multifamily, does it classify as commercial?
Because this CPACE actually will, the eligible properties include commercial buildings, agricultural buildings, nonprofit organizations, multifamily units with more than 5 units, and public buildings. And that goes to my point about the public works facility, because GNR have actually had a conversation about that. And they have not done public buildings yet, but they're very interested in working towards this. So that's something that we want to do that.
Can you do that even on a property that doesn't have property taxes?
Yes.
Interesting.
Yeah. this would be the
new... It's a property tax assessment on a property that doesn't pay property tax.
Yes. They would send you a bill, and it would be part of your assessment. It would be a new assessment. And we did... Cindy set up a meeting, and we spoke with the proper people, the Pickens County property people. Yeah. I knew it was Tom. That would do this, and they've agreed that they would do that. And as I said, John Ely has looked at all the documents.
Great.
So what the county has to do is opt into the voluntary district, sign the new energy oh gosh, I just went blank, the new energy industry district, the agreement, and then collect the annual payments as part of the property tax collection process, and then remit those collections to CPACE, and there's an organization called CPACE in Colorado. And then in November 1 of each year, annually just report all the properties that are participating in the program. And for that, a 1% fee would be added to the cost of a project. So say it's $100,000, it would be $100,000 plus $100.
No.
Or $1,000.
Yeah.
$1,000, sorry, math was off. So, and then the county would collect that for its costs of doing those tasks, implementing those tasks.
And so the commercial PACE program Colorado-wide has a pool of funds that they can loan to people up front to do the work,
right.
And then it is collected on a 20-year basis and repaid to that fund?
That's correct.
Okay,
yeah.
So we don't need to do any bonding, unlike residential PACE or anything like that is
right.
required from us.
Yeah, it's actually pretty simple. I think the biggest hurdle, if you will, is the counties have to opt into the program and rather than opt out. So,
and who is providing the pot of money that Colorado CPACE is able to?
So Sustainable Real Estate Solutions is the contractor that the state selected on a competitive basis, and they also administer Connecticut's, they administer a couple of other states, and they bring together the investors who are willing to finance this. Interest rates are somewhere between 4% and 6% for projects, so that's how they reap their return on their investment.
Okay. Patty?
Yeah, I think it's about time we were able to do this.
Yeah.
And I think we need to look forward to moving it forward. I just have one correction on page 12, the final page of the document you gave us.
Oh.
We have five commissioners. We need two more signature lines.
Oh, okay.
I think
my
the
apologies.
Standard for the rest of the counties that have opted
with
in.
Legal, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Just saying, unless you don't need all five of us to sign.
Okay.
No biggie, Mona.
Okay.
All right.
Another Rachel's last name is misspelled on both this and the previous one, Mona.
I'm sorry?
Rachel's name on the signature page is misspelled on this.
Oh my God.
And the rent one also.
Did I spell it wrong?
So that should be correct.
I didn't even catch that.
I copied it from the previous one.
Just need to change and read my signature anyhow. So.
Good, it's a work session.
Yeah, good thing it's a work session. I could correct the date.
Did you have any further details you needed to add on that program? How are you going to do outreach to commercial properties, let them know about?
Well, actually, we
and
have
is
a
there, is there an annual limit, too?
There is not an annual limit for the number of properties that can participate yet. Boulder counties, there's four counties that have opted in already, Adams, Broomfield, Boulder, and Eagle. And Broomfield has been doing deals for a few months now, and they've gone forward. The minimum is $30,000, and the maximum is quite large. I can't recall that. And I think it's ready to roll out, and there's other number of other counties that are considering it as well. Out of 64 counties, I think we'll probably see, you know, a good portion of them opt into the program. And how we'll market is we have Brad Davis, who's our commercial property, he's our commercial energy efficiency program manager, and he'll be talking. We already have had a request from one of the property owners who owns the Isis Theater. They were interested in going forward with it. Charlie has been talking with Hunter Creek about going forward with their solar system on their building. So I think there's some opportunities once we can get the word out and we can publicize it. I think we'll use our newsletter. As I said, we'll use our face-to-face interaction with the businesses that we work with, and then we'll reach out to some of the multifamily units. Charlie works with multifamily units as well. They have a hard time financing, or maybe not a hard time, but you know, it doesn't affect your borrowing rate. It doesn't, and you pay this, and you can finance it up to 20 years. So that's another positive aspect of it, so.
Okay, just a few more detailed questions. I'll come to Patty. Sure. Is this kind of something that will have a rolling application period during the course of the year? People can come in at any time. It's not like a deadline of August 5th or something? And,
right. Okay. It's a rolling program.
It's a rolling program.
It's there.
And then are there the type of similar, what I would call side rails that we have on our programs where either an energy audit or energy assessment of the property will be done first so that we're not plugging this problem, but they ignoring a larger energy loss somewhere else or something like that?
Yes, and they'll be working really closely with us, and they have a team of engineers on their staff as well that'll help oversee the project, which is really great because, you know, you might have some engineer that comes in and says, oh, you should do this, but they'll have an engineer that looks over all of the paperwork to make sure that it's really this project is going to have the payback that they predict that it's going to have, that it's going to perform the way it does, those kinds of things. So they have a full staff, which is really nice as part of this program.
Thank you. Patty's
this
questions?
Just real quick, has there been any interest in this program exhibited by Garfield County that we know of?
Well, from what I've heard, they're going to be discussing it sometime in September.
Okay.
And we're hopeful that that is the case. There was a workshop probably a month or so ago where they brought Tracy Phillips. He's the director from the Sustainable Real Estate Solutions Group. They brought him up. He did a workshop where about 20 contractors came. The idea was to promote it to Garfield County to say, hey, look, we have all this interest.
Great if we could get it valley-wide. I think that would be great.
I mean, it would be perfect if you have Eagle, Garfield, and Pitkin County, and it makes it that much easier for contractors and more attractive for property owners, and so it would be good.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Other board questions or comments about proceeding with commercial PACE buy-in, opt-in?
No, but having the residential would be great.
Okay. So, well, let me clear up that one, though. Board, I really need to. Does everyone want to move this forward? Yes.
No.
I didn't see anybody.
Yes. Okay.
Just a quick question. I mean, what's the downside? Why aren't more counties opting in, or they just haven't had this conversation yet? It's a relatively new program.
All of the above. We've had legislation in place for a couple of years. Gail Schwartz introduced it probably a couple of years ago, but then there were some issues, bless you, with some of the banking industry and some cleanup legislation that was required, and that actually got the final cleanup legislation just got signed this session. Mm-hmm. And so it's taken a while to put everything together and find the right program administrator. And you know, we've had some pushback at the federal level from Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac at the residential level. So I think the commercial, because this actually supersedes other loan agreements that you have. And so this will get paid off first. You can carry it forward as you sell the property, but it will continue with it remains with the property. So sometimes loaners, so they really had to work with the lending industry in Colorado to make sure, and really around the country, to make sure that they were going to be happy with this. So it's just taken a bit.
And if I recall correctly from our residential discussions a while ago before we decided that we would go forward with a bonding authorization, was from Tom Okun that because it's collected through property tax, it has a very, very low default rate. It is very highly, and I think it has the advantage of being tax deductible, but I'm not sure because it is a property tax. Is it collected at that time? Mm-hmm. So that's a big advantage for businesses. But that it's a secure a type of repayment source and loan source as you can get.
Yeah, so. It is. And Boulder County before, and I probably told you this before they got shut down by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, they issued like $10 million in bonds the first go around, and their default rate has been really low. And that included the commercial sector as well. So. And okay. Yes, Pitkin County did approve both residential and commercial in 2009. So. We've been sort of sitting and waiting.
Okay, so we're going to bring that back so it can formally opt in. Thanks for the details on it. And why don't you give us that brief update on residential PACE?
Great. So there's been some movement on the residential sector so far at the federal level. I talked with the folks at the state level with Paul Scharfenberger, who's the he coordinates the CPACE for Colorado Energy Office. And he said right now that because there isn't just 100% buy-in on it, people are still feeling a little bit skittish that they're not opting in until it's probably going to be a few months before they decide to opt in at the residential level. But they're really watching it very closely and just, you know, seeing how this all unfolds. So I think that the state will again take the lead on this once that they feel that going forward at the residential level is the right thing to do.
Okay, two questions. One is, do we need to wait for the state ourselves as a county if our voters have already approved that bonding authority? Or is it because we need a state partner to help be the administrator of it?
Well, I think it's probably the latter. It's the bonding would Pitkin County go forward with the bonding to provide this. Right now with the CPACE, we don't have to do any bonding.
Right.
That's available, the funds are available to us. So it's probably the latter more than the former.
Yeah, I mean, whether we're administering it through you or others, I appreciate there would be a gearing up time to start it. I guess perhaps in the future, the other thing, what I really would like is more a copy of what the FHA's new guidance was on these homes. I think it had more to do with the amount of equity someone would have in the home, the total price cap of the home, things like that. What qualifies seemed to be more about what they were willing to accept on a Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac loan.
Right.
So the technical parameters would be helpful for future discussion.
That sounds great. Okay.
Other board questions or comments on this item?
No, good information. Thanks.
Yeah, and that's all you guys need from us today. So
yes, we'll be back before you in a couple of weeks
14th.
On the 14th with resolutions that you can consider.
Okay.
Great.
Great. Thank you all very
Thank
much
you
for your
very
hard
much.
Work throughout the year. We really appreciate that. And board, we have a few minutes before we start our board interviews. So let's just take a quick 5-minute break and then come back around. So thank you, Grassroots. We're on break.
Involved in this. So far, 20 of them have indicated that they would be willing to have a discussion, and it's a pretty massive potential project for Healthy Rivers. I haven't brought it to the board yet because I'm not quite ready. I need to wait for people like Wildcat and the Forest Service and Toll Brothers to kind of get on board, but the underlying goal would be to leave more water in Snohomish Creek because that's the only option that we have if we start using more better quality water out of Brush Creek. So those are kind of my thoughts.
Okay. Other board questions?
I think you just covered everything.
Pretty much.
Really good.
Yeah, that was very encompassing. Steve?
Dave, I kind of observed that you and Lisa are changing parts of the valley because she used to live up there really close to where you're moving to on Missouri Heights. But
Both Lisas are training me on Missouri Heights.
Yeah, so I look forward to hearing your perception of when you're living up there. It's like the whole water regimen is different up there than it is on the north side of the Roaring Fork Valley north facing side, which it tends to be wetter and that tends to be drier over
right.
there. So I'll look forward to hearing if you have any observations seeing the valley from a different perspective than you're used to.
Well, there's a couple of things that are interesting up there. One is I have a ditch that runs right through my front yard, and it's currently in the slowdown phase, but it was interesting to see when the ditch gets turned on and when it gets turned off, and how just walking through the neighborhood, how the various connections to the water resources that are up there versus where I lived previously, which was pretty wet comparatively speaking.
Yes.
So it is a lot drier up there. There's a lot more direct agriculture up there than what I've experienced, other than the hay cutting and things that you find in the valley. The other thing that's interesting, and we'll see how this evolves, Michael's aware of this, is that Rudi Water and Power is looking at re-evaluating its direction and mission. And I've been working with Mark Fuller on how to help do that. I worked a little bit with Rachel a few years back on whether or not we could get adjacent counties to develop a Healthy Rivers type organization funded in some way, whether by general funds or taxes or whatever. And that didn't really get a lot of traction, particularly in Garfield County. But with the water plan now out there, there's a lot of organizations and individuals looking at how do we better manage our water resources. And the roundtable pretty much did its job. But now where do we go? And how do we make sure that we're executing not just on our priorities as identified in that plan, but what are the things that we can really get done and who should be in the lead? Because we can't manage Eagle or Gunnison or some of the other counties that are adjacent to us in a effective way unless we have a catalyst, and Mark thinks that might be them. I'm not sure of that yet, and I'm sure that board will decide, but I just see that as a huge challenge coming forward. So I'm happy to make sure that we focus on what's happening on that side of the watershed as I live there longer, and I see every day when I drive by all these giant fields with monster irrigation systems that are way more efficient than what I saw in the Stonemas Creek Valley.
Yeah, that's a good observation. I think it's just worth noting that the last 1177 Roundtable Basin meeting of the Colorado Basin, Lisa attended with Steve, and you know, it's nice to kind of start linking Healthy Rivers and Stream Board more closely to that effort. I know you and others have attended, you know, kind of on a periodic basis, and it starts to get where I have had more conflicts with my scheduling than to attend as many of those, so it's been really great to have Steve as a second there. They are going to be having their next steps meeting August 22nd, Monday, and it will be from noon to 2 p.m. at the offices of the River District. And so they're going to be having a grant presentation, the use of some of the PEPO funds, integrated water plan, stakeholder meeting, discussion, legacy project report. So you're absolutely right. We can do as much as we can as one entity, but we have to be in partnership with our other larger neighbors and entities. I'm going to go to the IBCC meeting in Denver tomorrow just so I can kind of see where they're going. They're supposed to be focused on funding issues for funding of water concerns. What was I thinking? And I guess other board member questions or comments for Dave? Michael?
Dave, you talked about water quality. Was it Brush Creek you were talking about? Have you talked to the Cozy Point people?
Yeah, I have talked to the City of Aspen. The City of Aspen open space management plan includes the potential for wetlands at the bottom of Cozy Point as a filter for water out of Brush Creek before it enters the Roaring Fork River and then passes on to county-owned property. In speaking with both April Long and the attorney for the City of Aspen, there's an openness to having a dialogue about how to maybe better utilize the dollars that would otherwise be spent there and to maybe do some mitigation further up. The city of Snowmass Village has a really poor stormwater treatment program. They're probably the biggest cause of some of the water quality issues, other than things that are hard to control, like the water that comes off the ski slopes. That said, SkiCo has offered to participate in a meaningful way, including potentially replanting some of the originally scraped slopes to try to mitigate some of the minerals that come into both branches of the Brush Creek. So we have people who are willing to play, but what we can't do is have downstream users take the water that we save or improve. So trying to make sure that if in fact we are able to improve the water such that the golf course and or Cozy Point can be used as a natural filter, and the golf course is probably a better filter than Cozy Point because of the volume of water that they use, and also the fact that there'd be some return flows out of it. So the issue for me there is I don't want Wildcat taking the water that we save in Brush Creek out of Snowmass Creek, because there's going to have to be a trade-off. And I don't know if that's going to involve the water trust, where we can prevent that from happening, or what. At this point, it's kind of an open issue. I've been slowly talking to each constituency and trying to get them to go together. The biggest hurdle I see is Wildcat and Somas Village, because it's going to be an expensive project for them to improve a very archaic stormwater system that is now a larger problem than the microinvertebrate issues they had before. In fact, the designation as a poor quality
impaired
stream has been removed as of March. That said, if you take water out of the outflows of the two major inlets out of Snowmass Village stormwater system, it's pretty bad. So they're basically bypassing that water into the about where the roundabout is. So they're not measured the way it was measured before, where they measured up on the mountain and they measured at the district treatment plant and then they measured at the roundabout. So I'd like to see this whole thing, you know, be organized in a way that you can bring everybody into a room and say, here's the issues. What are you willing to do? How are you willing to participate? And then it would be a major improvement for our watershed to get that not only better than it was when it was impaired, and that had more to do with minerals than anything, and chemicals off the golf course, than now it's more of a stormwater issue. But in the end, if you don't,
yeah,
still got to trade that water from Brush Creek to Snowmass Creek to improve that
flow there.
What about the issue of turbidity in Brush Creek? How's that dealt with?
Well, that's part of the issue, is that turbidity is caused by a lot of the minerals that flow off. And Kit Hamby doesn't believe that you can fix that problem with filtration, because it just would be an overwhelming cost. And you'd be better off improving the stormwater treatment issues, which have also been exacerbated by things like the Viceroy dumping raw sewage into it. The turbidity can be solved more by using the golf course as a natural filter. The amount of effort and cost associated with doing that would be significantly less, because you can just create a natural wetlands right at the treatment plant and then have it step down. If you wait until the water gets all the way to the bottom, you can only keep so much volume in that quote-unquote wetlands that they're going to build, and that, so you're still going to flow untreated water through that wetlands in across the county property into the Roaring Fork River.
This, as you described it earlier, is a little bit of an individual exploration and beginning to talk to people. I do think this sounds like a great initiative for the Healthy Rivers and Stream Board as a whole, and the county as a whole, and just kind of working it within some of the other items. You're right in that water issues tend to take time and kind of ease people along and into it and participate, that they're not automatically worrying about a price tag as opposed to worrying about goals and outcomes that can be achieved. So I really want to thank you for taking that on and starting the dialogues and discussions about it.
John and Laura have been very actively involved in this. I actually started with them.
Okay.
To see if it made sense, and if, you know, at the appropriate point, we could make it a county issue.
Okay. Thank you so much for that. Steve, we're kind of out of time to move into the next interview. Okay. If you have a very quick question.
Well, I just wanted to point out that Dave started attending the Snowmass Water and Sanitation District meetings quite a few years ago as people representing Snowmass Creek, and I'm glad to see that you're continuing that interest in what's happening to the water over on the Brush Creek side.
Thank you.
Now we can't wait to see what you do in Garfield County.
Yeah.
That'll be a challenge.
So again, thank you very much for your service, and we'll be discussing this later in terms of reappointments and let you know.
Great. Thanks. Thank
I have
you
to
very much.
Check in and see if we have other applicants and things like that for
cool.
These districts. To interview.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you. Carry on. Lisa, why don't you come on up? Appreciate having both of you in here on the same day. That's always valuable.
Yeah.
And so really would start off with you with some of the same type of questions. Why are you reapplying? What do you like to do in the future? How's it going so far?
I think that I'm very happy to be on this board. It's just been an absolute amazing learning experience. It's been about 7 years now. I think we're getting into about a 7-year period, I think, and at the end of this year, which is to me just amazing that we've been around for that long. But I am reapplying because we have many, many more projects that are still out there and on the books. And as you just said, Rachel, you said it takes a very long time to really sort of get a lot of these ideas out there, and you kind of want to focus on goals and outcomes and for perhaps years with people before you can actually get a project on board. Mm-hmm. And I really would like to just continue pursuing a lot of the things that we have started to pursue. One of them this year is, and it is pretty much precipitated by the Colorado Water Plan that just was passed, obviously last December, I believe, one of Hickenlooper's goals, and certainly up for a great deal of discussion just exactly what kind of impact that's going to have on water supply in the state and in our Roaring Fork Valley, the size of Delaware, the Roaring Fork watershed. So we have been diving into looking into the issue of waste as it applies to the duty of water, and just trying to get ourselves educated on, you know, how that might play out as far as helping ranchers increase water efficiencies, and what that means when they do that, and what exactly waste does mean. It's being looked at differently in different regions around Colorado. We're in Division 5, and it's being looked at differently in other divisions around the state, depending on, you know, their particular issues that are going on. I mean, in the South Platte River, everything's pretty much under a call or under scrutiny for administration all the time. And even in our local area here, like you were just discussing, living on Missouri Heights, you notice there's more sprinkler systems up there than there are, say, in the Snowmass Valley. And a lot of that is because, you know, water is scarcer up there. You don't have your water right for nearly as long a time as many people do in the Snowmass Creek area. So they have been more interested, you know, there's more incentive for them to create efficiencies and to use sprinklers, for example. So the Rivers Board would like to look into, and we have already, as you know, with the East Mesa Ditch, we have been helping them with increase some of their water delivery efficiencies. And so I'm really looking forward to how far we can take this, and I think we're just now scratching the surface. So there's a great deal of possibility out there. So it's going to take some time for us to learn, and I don't know if you know about this white paper, I guess you would call it, that came out from CSU in February this year, How Diversion and Beneficial Use of Water Affect the Value and Measure of a Water Right. This has been a bit of a big splash and is being heavily debated. I don't know if Rachel's heard a little bit.
I was aware of this at all.
Yeah, so it says is use it or lose it an absolute? And it's a very interesting topic. And for example, it says, just I'll read this one sentence. The term use it or lose it is commonly associated with the incorrect belief that by maximizing the amount of water that you divert, so you go with your paper water right, you say, I have this paper water right, and you absolutely divert that paper water right, regardless of need, one can enhance or preserve the magnitude of a water right in a future transfer or protect it from some other reduction. And this is not correct. Mm-hmm. So the true measure of a water right is its actual historical beneficial consumptive use. So we have not touched on any of that in this watershed, and there are various reasons that are very complicated when you start to dive into waste, and you know, you start talking about tailwater, and you start talking about downstream water rights and junior water rights. So, but I think there's an incredible amount of possibility regarding this topic and regarding actually potentially getting real wet water in the rivers.
Yeah, your comments really, and combined with Dave's, point out the great complexity and perhaps the great opportunities, but at the same time great threats that we have, because this and others all come back to that same thing of, well, once you've saved water and have it in the stream, what is to prevent someone else from diverting it or not? And just to mention this really briefly, I did participate with the discussion the city was having about their diligence rights on their reservoirs. And, you know, I'm not in favor of reservoirs or dams, but if they were to renew those rights for a six-year period with, again, clearly no intention, no financing, no engineering, no votes, they're not going forward, it seems, in any way, but use that time period to see if we could create a new beneficial right through Colorado water law to, I'm thinking of something that you could call an assurance flow, a compact assurance flow, because when we look at Powell, and then we look at the basic inadequacy of any sort of water banking effort to truly protect the West Slope, and yet we have all these rivers and streams with kind of very small fractions of water that we'd like to see preserved, whether it's the Crystal, whether it's, you know, Snowmass Creek, whether it's Brush Creek, and that if we could create a new way to create something in addition to minimum stream flows, essentially, something that would layer on top of that and a safe harbor for the additional water we're saving, it would be, I'm sure, a multi-year effort because water law is very difficult to change or pursue, but at the same time, everyone on the Front Range is dependent on us fulfilling our compact obligations. And that, so that's the type of thing I'd love to start seeing that came to me from that meeting. But again, there's a lot of opportunities, a lot of challenges, and some projects could take, you know, a decade to see successfully implemented. But let me turn it back to other board member questions for Lisa regarding her time on the board.
I have one quick comment.
Okay,
on
please.
That.
And then we'll go to Steve.
Okay.
So you go ahead.
Yeah, I think, Rachel, that's great. Yes, I mean, we absolutely have got to start, you know, thinking bigger than within Colorado water law. We can all stay nice, and there certainly are some amazing opportunities working within Colorado water law. I think that, you know, we haven't quite, you know, dived into them, whatever the word is. But I do also believe, and I really do think this board is in a very unique position. And as Dave was talking about, I mean, we have over the years talked about from the very beginning, how could we get other, you know, counties to climb on board. I also do believe that there is going to be some sort of legislative answer, and it's going to take a long time, it's going to take years, but I do think eventually we probably are going to have to amend, you know, it's like the 1872 mining law, the Colorado water law, you know, maybe as soon as the lords of yesteryear aren't quite so much in charge and we've got some younger millennials, you know, I welcome them. So that's one of the reasons why I think it feels important to me to remain on the board because of the knowledge that I've gained over the years, and it has built. And so now I feel like I've gotten to the point of, you know, being able to think a lot more creatively with that, instead of just always trying to figure out, you know, what are you talking about? What are the facts? You know, how does the law work? And so I feel like I'm finally at a place where, you know, maybe I can start, you know, inching out and trying to find some other solutions. But anyway.
Thank you. Steve?
Yeah, other people from other parts of the state are kind of in awe that we actually have a dedicated tax fund for healthy rivers and streams. So what you guys do is important as a showcase for possibilities, and I know a lot of what we've been able to do is just small baby steps so far, but it's good that you're thinking of the grand scheme of things. Since you made the move from Missouri Heights to the city of Aspen, you have a little bit, you know, perhaps a different perspective on the water situation in the valley, and I know you've already expounded a lot on parts of that, but are there any other things you can think of that perceptions you have from having lived in two different parts of the Roaring Fork?
Well, I guess first first off is just personal, and that is when I was in a subdivision on Missouri Heights. It wasn't a very big subdivision, but it was a new one, and we had probably one of the best raw water rights, and we also had wells that were we had two wells that were pretty predictable, fortunately, but I was absolutely astounded to see just who might steal water. It's like anybody might steal water. It's like they might be the nicest, most straightforward, most church-going person in the world, but you know, when water gets tight, which it did in my subdivision as far as the raw water was concerned, which meant that your landscaping could suffer because we had a certain amount of raw water that came through our sprinkler systems for a certain period of time, and it was, you know, it wasn't a senior water right as far as, you know, a lot of other water rights on Missouri Heights. So I had that experience, and now living in Aspen right now, I can tell you it's really lovely that you know that you can turn the water on and water your landscape without, you know, upsetting your neighbors or, but anyway. But I loved the incentive out on Missouri Heights to really, you know, think a little differently about water and to, you know, try and plant xeriscaping and native plants, which I absolutely did. But I had an opportunity because I moved into the middle of a hay field, and so it was a blank slate as far as my house was concerned. But so that's all. It's just going from sort of where water's a little bit short on Missouri Heights to the city of Aspen, where, you know, we don't have that issue, but you have the issue of your own. Well, first of all, it's going to cost you more money, but your own moral implications and pressures and incentives to not overwater. But
okay. Thank you. And any other last board questions?
No, thanks, Lisa. Thanks for your time.
Yeah,
absolutely.
And the last thing I'd just say in general for both you and Dave and Lisa, we greatly appreciate the assistance in trying to sort through and filter some of these many issues. And it is hard to prioritize. There's little ground fires everywhere in a certain way. Lisa participated with me last week with this special meeting that Rudai Water and Power Authority had with the Bureau of Reclamation about the calls for the fish water coming down through the frying pan for the endangered fish. And of course, the long-term future there is that when all those contract waters come at the same time, that river will be unfishable for a lot of the year. And they have brought it up to 300 cubic feet per second now, which makes it relatively unfishable, and certainly unwadable. And so that's detrimental. And the odd thing is, after we went through, and I'm sure this board remembers hearing reports about the 10825 endangered fish water for several years, and the agreement was made, X amount would come out of Granby, and X amount would come out of, Grand Lake, and X amount would come out of Rudai. Well, that has been flipped on its head because they leased the Conservancy water and are using that as fish water now. So we're back up to the higher numbers that we saw before the 10825 agreement was ever reached. And there is simply nothing in the future, as things are drier in our area and hotter 10 or 20 years out, from seeing all those calls come down at once. So you could have 400, 500 CFS per moment and a flume in that river that will destroy the fishery over time. And it's just the course that's heading on, unless we are all able to find some sort of new intervention and the type of plumbing that should have been installed with the dam in the first place, that you can't use the river itself as a delivery flume. So there's a lot of issues out there that we're all going to need to stay right on top of, and really appreciate your service and evaluating and ranking these priorities, as it were, and engaging our regional partners.
Yeah, thanks for giving me a new hobby, Colorado water law.
All right. It's a lifelong hobby.
Thank you both very much, and again, we'll check in. Lisa, do we have any other applicants at this time to interview?
No new applicants. Andre will be in front of you, I think, next week.
Okay, and then how long have we been advertising for? Okay, so the decent time period. That's great. Thank you again very much. You guys have a good week. And board, we did take a really short little break before. Does anyone want to break now or just keep pushing forward with the agenda?
I like to move forward.
Yeah. Okay, let's do that then, John. So the next item is the review of future agendas.
You can come up early.
Yeah, and I just haven't mentioned, if Charlotte or Susan are listening, maybe give John Kinney a call.
Yeah, well, we'll still work that break in, but yeah.
For future agendas, just a couple items. Next week, We'll be adding a lease slash permit for the Forest Service on Loge Peak. As one we thought we might have to do an emergency on today, but we do not. So that will be on next week's agenda, either Tuesday or Wednesday. We think we can do it as we would on a regular meeting after visiting with the Forest Service. So,
okay.
Also, Open Space and Trail staff and I were up at the Snowmass Village Council meeting. They had placed us on for an update of the ballot language. We had originally talked about maybe doing that as a joint meeting, but we did talk briefly with the council about doing a joint meeting in the first week of October. They would like to have a discussion about the history and future of open space and trails again. They're taking a great interest in it, a very supportive conversation, but we'll try and get that scheduled with their staff probably the first or second week of October to
be a great opportunity.
Do that joint meeting. And we also are going to be getting scheduled probably before that a joint meeting with the hospital board, more to come on that. So that would probably come in September at this point. So with that, I don't have any other items for future agendas.
I have a couple.
Patty?
On August the 23rd, we have at the very end of our agenda, we have a 9th Judicial District presentation, pre-trial services. Do you have any clue as to what that is?
Pre-trial services, I believe, is a pre-sentencing program as far as keeping folks diverted from the jail.
Opportunities, and, plea
yeah.
bargaining.
Well, whatever. It's diverted from the jail while they're waiting, trial and such. The purpose of the update, I'm not totally clear on
okay.
that.
Well, then, okay, that gives me enough. And then on the 24th at our regular meeting, we're having a thing, the Emergency Managers Performance Grant. Is that just a grant that we've been able to get?
Yeah, that's one that comes through on a regular basis.
And then we are not going to have, that I could find, a work session discussion prior to our Deer Creek Open Space IGA, and I believe that's the one. That one, the first read on that is, I think, September the 14th.
Check.
I think that's the agreement we're trying to work out with the Department of Parks and Wildlife.
Yeah, I thought we had a half hour.
Open Space and Trails meeting on the 6th.
Are we discussing it there?
I would hope so. That's what I had thought.
Yeah, I would like us to have a discussion before we get to first read.
Okay, I thought I saw it on here, but
did you just look at
you can make a notation and make sure that we discuss
yeah,
it.
Yeah, so we have it actually next week, the 23rd. There's a half hour at 3:15 for Deer Park discussion.
Oh, okay, so it is on there before our first reading on the 24th.
Yeah.
Okay. I just didn't see it there, lost in all of the
other items.
See that.
Okay.
It may have gotten added.
Oh, no, here it is. Okay. I got it. Okay. Thanks, John. I just didn't catch that.
Okay. Other items that the board may have? Anyone? Anything on that? I have something here. I'm just trying to double check. I guess that's kind of all for me. John, do you perceive a need that we might have to schedule, I don't know, an hour or something to really kind of pull all some of these different parts and pieces we have together, given the large project at the county building and the move and communications? And I mean, I think we've been keeping up to speed fairly well, but now that it's launching, there's more tangential items that become apparent, whether it's side MOUs or how the staging will occur and how we get public notice out. I just have wondered whether some of it would be a repeat of items we've already mm-hmm. been caught up with, but I just have wondered whether for the public and the board it might be good to schedule just a kind of an overview, review, you know, literally as we're going into budget season, of expected expenses, and you'll be seeing this in the budget, things like that. I don't know if others feel the same way, but it just is, I just know we have potentially tens of millions of expenditures going out at once and a lot going on, and we're going to be a hair more disconnected given the offices in Basalt versus mm-hmm. up here.
So Rachel, and just to understand, are you looking for maybe a work session that kind of give a overview of all our major projects right now and kind of where we're at?
I'm thinking more about focusing here in town with
on the facilities.
Just because today's meeting discussion the energy improvements mm-hmm. as a possibility. Well, we're going to have to reaffirm that later, but to kind of refresh us, this has been a multi-year process, and there may be times when there's going to be new decision points that we can anticipate coming down of spending decisions or things like that. So I'll just let you on that. But today's discussion and some other items as they come forward, I just want to make sure we all feel we got our arms all the way around it and future, again, how we're going to handle the dislocation for a period of time. Patty?
Yeah, I don't necessarily see the need for that other than we'll get so much of the funding decision points during the budget, would be my understanding. But if John feels that there's some key things that he could feel that we need to know, but.
Well, and I think maybe what you're keying in on is today we had a couple disconnects in the conversation. So does it make sense to go back and talk about the kind of key decision points that we've taken and are running with and where we're at in the process and the.
Yeah, and I think Patty's comment is great, that perhaps what it is more about tying it into the budget presentation and perhaps giving an overview of those projects and what will be required next and going forward before we break into general fund and individual funds and things like that. But just a refresher at some level of how we're going to manage this time period and overview.
Well, and I think we're going to find in this budget it is going to be a lot about this is a big implementation year. This isn't going to be a lot of new initiatives here, so it's a good time to revisit what does that mean and what can we expect to see. So
does that mean we're not coming up with new projects this year?
I wouldn't guarantee it, but we're discouraging it. Yeah.
Okay. So if anyone else has any other future agenda items or any new travel or absentee items come up, be sure to let John know so that he can, and I'll get you, Steve, so that we have a quorum. Go ahead,
Rachel,
Steve.
On the 25th is the CCI Mountain District meeting, which I will be attending, and I think you might be at the Colorado Water Congress.
I will be at Water Congress, so I will not be attending.
So and we don't really have to have it on the agenda, but I just wanted to.
Okay,
it's the CCI Mountain.
You know that I will be at the Mountain District meetings.
Okay,
we'll have that covered.
Thank you very much for that, Steve. I really appreciate that.
Can I ask a question about is this the district meeting where legislative items would start to be discussed, or
yes, they usually float around. These are the things we've heard. There's no vote. It's just comments and questions and things like that.
Okay, nothing that we need to prepare for in terms of.
Well, did we submit one this year?
We did, and I think I can be prepared at that meeting too. Maybe I should talk to you before, just so I'm sure I have all the right bullet points.
Yeah,
because we'll have opportunity to.
It was the request that the state increase its share of the cost of the restaurant inspection fee program.
Right.
And so some of the backgrounding that we will eventually use to make our case is going to be important. The all committee meetings of CCI is September 30th, Friday, September 30th, and that's when they will be voting up and down what to take forward. Their legislative agenda.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. You're welcome. Okay, well, given that, we can now get rid of my future agenda. That won't tell me anything right now. There's the other one. We cycle supplemental budget requests.
Well, so we have people. The trouble with getting so far ahead is, we've got folks
coming
in.
Do you have open discussion items that no one is coming in for that you need to broach with us?
I don't at this time, no.
Okay. Do board members have open discussion items that we
can? I have one. I wanted to bring back a discussion that Michael first brought forth in terms of these rental ATVs. I was up Castle Creek on Saturday, and I saw two ATVs just flying up that road, and I was driving down, and I tried to see whether they were licensed, and the only thing I could see on their license plate was rent me. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So here they are, and I had a constituent who was up there the week before And he said that he saw several that were really actually dangerously going fast and turning around without looking. And so this looks like this is getting into a public safety issue. And so I'm not sure if we need to bring the sheriff in on this and what our authorization is, but it's an accident waiting to happen.
Yeah, so these vehicles are not street legal. They're not licensed. They are tagged through, I want to say it's Division of Parks and Wildlife, I believe, that you get a tag for the ATV or UTV vehicles. We do have Brian Pettit right now looking into legislation that was passed that gives counties the authority to allow, I believe how it works, and so we'll get a briefing from Brian, is that they are not allowed on public or county roads unless the board takes an affirmative action to allow those vehicles on county roads. They are allowed on Forest Service roads. So on the county roads, I think, George, it is an enforcement issue. It may be something that we need to talk to the sheriff's department about. My understanding is from the city side that they have reached agreements with the folks who are renting them to allow them to operate on the city streets to reach like the summer road and the gas station. I have seen quite a few there. So there is that. But on Castle Creek Road, on the paved portion in particular, they would not be allowed. Going up Pearl Pass on the Forest Service, roads up there, they would be allowed if they're properly stickered with the Division of Wildlife. So it may be appropriate to talk to Joey if we're seeing them outside. We are going to bring a discussion back to the board vis-a-vis this legislation and whether there's any areas you do or want to designate otherwise they won't be allowed.
Because this is more than just gassing up in town and taking being able to access Afton Mountain. I mean, you're going up 13 miles up Castle Creek Road,
and that's definitely not allowed.
And I would just suggest that before we talk to Joey, or as we talk to Joey, the key, at least at this point, this season, this year, is to talk to the rental agencies and make sure they know they are not allowed on Castle Creek Road. Allowed on Forest Service roads as we know it today, because that's a major departure. We did bring this up briefly with the city when we had our joint meeting to tell them it was starting to really show us an issue and we're going to need their cooperation on it. But you're absolutely right, and I spoke with someone at a gathering last week who is up more that Castle Creek area, and they're sitting there starting to see them more regularly and just kind of sometimes parked and left in turnarounds for days. And people come back and get them, is what I heard.
I think we need to get ahead of this, especially because not just because summer's coming to the end, but we're going to have the fall colors where we're going to see a lot of traffic specifically up our drainages in Castle Creek Road.
Okay. Thank you. Michael?
Well, I think we should have a community discussion before we ask for an enforcement or anything like that. The city of Aspen, we need to talk to them, because if they're saying it's okay to go on city streets, well, why is that okay? And do you realize it has implications for our streets and our safety outside of the city streets? So, and the renters, and I think people did it because there was kind of a vacuum, right? There wasn't any straight rules. So I think the community discussion has to involve the city of Aspen, has to involve the people who rent the vehicles, it has to involve the Chamber of Commerce, it has to involve a number of people.
Sooner than later.
Yeah. I mean, there's letters in the newspapers saying, I can't go up on Richmond Ridge without being inundated by those vehicles.
I agree with that, but I think in terms of our roles and responsibilities as a county is if these are not street legal, then that needs to be addressed immediately, at least on county roads. And if the city wishes to sort of condone it or overlook it,
it's not helpful. That's what I'm saying. It's,
right.
It's not helpful to take for us to take a position that's actually contrary to the city of Aspen's position, because that position is essentially where the inception of those vehicles is, right? If immediately they can't leave whatever lot they're in because they can't travel city streets, then we don't have to worry about it. Yeah. But if we have to somehow battle the city of Aspen, and you know, that's...
Yeah, I think Michael brings up a really good point about how we need to take a comprehensive view and a comprehensive look. It's obviously something that's just started to go forward. And at a certain point, it's hard to tell whether these are all rental vehicles, or now that these vehicles are becoming so very popular, people aren't buying them themselves for their homes and their recreation when they get back here. The challenge, I think, that I see, similar to George, that's more direct, is a paved road like Castle Creek. And it's been our understanding so far, as we started to look into it at all this summer, is that the rental shop is by the butcher block. They're letting people gas up here, and they're going up the face of Aspen Mountain and abiding with the Forest Service travel management plans and traveling in those areas. But what we're all foreseeing is that there are residential neighborhoods that you can then start to buzz through on the way back down to Castle Creek, and maybe you feel like you've gotten a little too jarred and bumpy during the ride, and you now let's go back that way. And it's like, no, this is not allowed. And so I think that at the very least we could start talking to the operators about not that, make sure they know that their people know that they're not allowed on Castle Creek Road, and they can be stopped by the sheriff and ticketed and fined, as is appropriate for having a non-street legal vehicle on a county road. But there is a much bigger discussion, and I know Steve knows this through both our efforts at CCI as this is going forward, to make sure we maintain the local control and the county ability to close off roads, that it doesn't become automatically that every county road is now open for these types of vehicles. And it is a real hodgepodge of details. Agricultural uses are exempt so that young people can ride ATVs to do farm work and things like that, or take care of the ranches. Some vehicles have to be licensed and insured, similar to dirt bikes, that the city kind of looks the other way as people go through town with dirt bikes. But others aren't necessarily equipped to be insured and licensed. And there is something that also confuses things with the larger national, we've all adopted the same highway code, traffic code, as it were, as a nation. And so what's happening is people are licensing their vehicles in another state, and it is licensed there because they have lower licensing standards, but then the license kind of carries over here, and it's been that Colorado residents couldn't license them. And then so a Colorado resident would be told, no, you can't drive on Castle Creek, but the guy who brings his ATV in and his license in Minnesota can go up on our same road. So it was a real inequity between these residents, and they've been trying to sort it out. And that's why, as much as I'd like to spring into action this summer, I think it's more about doing what we can this summer, having the larger conversation, bringing all the comprehensive elements into it. Between the user groups, certainly, as well as the residential neighborhoods that may be impacted by seeing their main driveways and roads turn into a recreation area, and come out with some policies that are, you know, mutually agreed upon or beneficial, and will get the job done by next summer. And so that's kind of where we have it today. I wish it was as straightforward.
Well, I think it part of it may be straightforward. If these are not street legal and they're going up Castle Creek Road, a county road, that we can have the sheriff's department ticket them, fine them, whatever their
speeding
authority is to do.
Yeah, I fully agree with that, and I wasn't disagreeing with that. I'm saying we should do that, but we should also talk to the operators in advance to hopefully tell them that to their people, you can't go on these roads.
So there's obviously a conflict between sometimes acting quickly and having the bigger community discussion. So I just want to check in. I think what I'm taking away from this conversation is that we should issue a letter just reminding that the rental companies that the ATV, UTV vehicles are not allowed on county roads, particularly paved county roads, as both a licensing and safety issue. Talk to the sheriff's department about enforcement, which is difficult because it's you may have a sheriff's deputy there, you may not, you know, at any given time, but to ensure that
it's like
when
catching
that
a trucker on the pass
happening.
Well, just so they have a heads up, though.
And then longer term, as we bring back what the state legislation allows for this board, maybe do a work session with this board about what discretion you have under the state law, and then from there decide on a broader community discussion. Should you want to go there with all the user groups and maybe affected entities, about maybe roads that you'd want to designate for use or not.
Yeah.
Did I capture that?
Mm-hmm. That's accurate. Okay. I think the last thing any of this one on this board wants is another Lenado snowmobile parking issue, because that's the next step of people just hauling them to trailheads that are legitimate Forest Service travel management plans, but there's still no parking area for the trailers or the fees and things like that. So there's going to be a lot that goes into this, and it may be something that we ask for the input or assistance from Open Space and Trails or you know, literally what other communities have done to manage this. Patty?
If we're done with that, I have one quick.
Okay, yes.
And this is another one, John, for the sheriff's office. And I don't know if George and Steve have seen it. The parking lot by the put-in takeout by Holland Hills, right before you cross over the bridge across from Lazy Glen, has turned into a used car lot. There's been multiple cars, and one of them was an ATV, UTV,
whatever
you want to call it, for sale, with for sale signs all over it. But it was there for a couple of days without being. I know they ticket them after a certain period of time, but there were like four cars lined up there, and you drove by. If I was from out of town, I would have said, yeah, they have a used car lot right here on the highway.
That kind of springs up and goes away.
And I don't know how they enforce it, but maybe if they could do what they normally do.
Okay.
I don't think they do anything, Patty.
They ticket them every once in a while. You'll see a flag on them.
Yeah. It's an abandoned vehicle issue, as it were. Very good. Other open discussion items? Okay, we may come back to that if anything else comes up, but now we can go back to our regular scheduled events, and we will go to the WeCycle supplemental budget request. And so please call them up to the table and identify yourselves for the record, and I don't know if, GR, you want to introduce the topic?
Sure. I'm GR Fielding, I'm the county engineer, and I'm joined today by Mirta Mallory from WeCycle. We have a budget supplemental request, and as the board might remember, November of 2015, we had a conversation with WeCycle about where their operation was, and it was an update to the board, since Pitkin County is one of the founding members of WeCycle. At that time, the board had committed $40,000 to WeCycle, and through the conversation, it evolved from a soft commitment to a hard commitment for that money. It was for implementation of the stations that are in Basalt. At the meeting, there was a few different funding options that were bandied about with staff and the board. Unfortunately, the two main ones that we had discussed were CMAQ and EOTC. CMAQ funds are really to be spent within the UGB of Aspen, as that's the maintenance area for the air quality. And so that took that funding opportunity off of the table for this. Plus, with CMAQ and going through the state grant cycle, it takes a pretty long time to get the project in the queue, get it funded, and move forward that way. With the EOTC, one of the issues that we had is that we would have to prove that this benefited the entrance to Aspen and was transit oriented, and so we had a similar one geography issue and some other things that would have to happen before that argument can be made for those funds. So that brings us back to what we have today of the supplemental request, which would be out of the general fund balance.
And that is a kind of a sub account underneath the general fund, within the general fund, that's for capital within Public Works Department. Is that correct?
And some others, but yes, this is funded by 52% of the sales tax revenue, and it's.
Yeah, and so we've consolidated our public works and road projects, our IT projects and replacement, and facilities projects within the capital plan. We did have, you may recall from an earlier briefing, that we did have savings on projects that carried forward into the budget, so that's the fund balance that you're seeing now. And the only thing I'd add, I believe, GR, that in the November meeting, because we went back and watched it, so I believe this firmly, that the discussion was to come back. We had largely finished our budget at that point, and so we had intended to bring this back as a supplemental after we had explored these budget items for various reasons. I think a new addition to GR's family distracting them at that point, as well as you know, I think a feeling that a hard commitment had been made. This issue came back up because WeCycle, understanding that commitment, had sent us a bill and we had not appropriated the funds yet. So we are back. Yeah, we are back in front of you now. With this, and having looked at some of those alternatives that the board was brainstorming, and that we couldn't use them, we had made a hard commitment at that point to leverage funds from Basalt for the implementation, which has happened. I've seen the WeCycle stations there.
And I just wanted to clarify, because I know when I first read the budget supplemental, I was like, what? We're down to just $834,000 in the, you know, general fund reserves? It's like, no, this is a sub-account within that account. So that's why I was trying to clarify.
Better than we expected to be in the capital fund.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah.
And so, Marta, why don't you give us a brief overview of how the implementation in Basalt has gone? And I think a lot of us were real excited to see it down there before our temporary offices fully open up down there. So go ahead, please.
We'll be ready for you when you come down.
Okay.
We're fortunately, down you'll tomorrow, still have this space where you also have a station right next to you here in Rio Grande. So, yes, WeCycle opened in the Basalt, Willits, and Elgibel area in late May of this year with 23 stations and 80 bicycles. We have these smaller stations, which is new this year, which are these small satellite stations, which allow us to have stations in neighborhoods such that you don't just have one big station that you have to walk to, and thereby are less encouraged to use it, and it's less convenient. And so, for example, the Elk Run neighborhood has three little stations rather than one large one. The station that you helped support is the BRT station right next to your new offices. And it is in Pickens County, and hopefully you've seen it. It's been moved in anticipation of the underpass. It has been moved right next to the bus stop. So it's highly visible in terms of creating a connectivity between bus and bike and multimodal transit, and trying to encourage individuals, rather than driving to the park and ride, to using a bike. That is our most popular station in the system at this point in time, is that BRT station. So it's very convenient in terms of its seamless integration. The system is averaging around 38 rides per day at this point in time between the two systems, which we're pleased with. And what's most interesting about the Basalt system, given that it's its first year, is that 92% of the rides so far this year are made up by season pass holders. So we're seeing a much lower percentage of visitors using the system or day pass holders than we do up in the Aspen system. And we are encouraged by that, as that was the intention of the system, which was to provide connectivity to transit and to grocery stores and to commercial centers. And that's indeed how the system's being used. We're learning how to balance the system that is spread out by about 4 miles between Willits and Elgibel. So that's a process that's taking some time, but at the same time is providing new opportunities and synergies. And the only other component that I think is really exciting to highlight today is that WeCycle was the recipient of a Better Bike Share Partnership grant. We're one of 9 communities nationwide to receive funding to support bike share equity, and our focus is on the Latino community. So we have 2 dedicated Latina outreach coordinators who are going into the different communities in Basalt and we have translated our materials into Spanish, and we are working at engaging and making sure that this system is equitable and engaging for all different, the entire community as a whole. Basalt received this grant in conjunction with Milwaukee, Berkeley, Brooklyn, Atlanta, Boston, and Minneapolis. So that's really exciting. So that's a program that we're going to continue and to optimize and to learn how to make it most effective. So it's off to a really good start, and we're looking forward to the rest. We have 2.5 months left, so anyone who hasn't had an opportunity to try, come ride down to the Basalt area. There's also a Basalt free trial going on right now for those who might think, how does this work? I want to give it a try at the WeCycle website. So thank you all for your continued support of this program.
And it was exciting to see after our joint meeting with Eagle County down in Basalt at the RMI building that the Eagle County commissioners took a tour of the area on the WeCycle. So that was good. Patty?
Well, first, as far as the funding, yes.
Okay.
Secondly, I do have a favor or suggestion, or maybe you can help me with this. Since I spend a lot of time walking the downtown Aspen Core, I'm seeing that more and more WeCycle bikes are being ridden on the sidewalks and through the mall. I don't know if you could put something up at the downtown center, you know, the recycle stations, that says, please try to stay off the sidewalks and do not ride your bikes in the pedestrian mall. We've had a lot of bike activity in the community, and walking through the mall with a dog on a leash or with my husband who's disabled, it's getting a little sketchy. And they're not all WeCycle bikes, but I think that if there's a pattern set and we can get them up. So just a thought, if you guys could put some kind of, because I know they don't know all the rules of the road, because Aspen, City of Aspen Core bicycle rules are very confusing. But at least the mall and the sidewalks, if they could just try and stay off those, that would be great.
We'll definitely put word out to our pass holders and work with the city parks in terms
that
of signage.
That would be great. Whatever you can do, and definitely to the funding, yes.
Okay. Other comments or questions? Steve?
I haven't had the opportunity to ride in Basalt or Elgeville yet, because whenever I'm there, I'm always in my car, and you know, I might do one errand in Basalt and then the next errand in Elgeville. However, in Aspen, I really appreciate the app, because it is makes it so useful to see where there is, make sure there's a bike available. You can get the code to check a bike out without having my little key with me, and that's very handy. And also, I can help you in rebalancing the bikes, because you can see where if there's a full station and I have a choice. I can ride to Pepke Park, or I could ride to 8th Street. Well, where do you need bikes left off? And I can actually look on there and
that's awesome.
And actually help you rebalance. So,
thank you.
And also, to me, the nicest ride in town is like from Galena Plaza to the music festival. And one day I'm like zooming through all the neighborhoods over past the red brick, and I come across a little bit slower bicycle on a WeCycle bike, and it was Steve Scadron also going to the music tent. So we had a little race going down the residential streets.
Those two on
very good.
Who got to the dock first?
Very good. Okay, so is the rest of the board supportive as well of this funding? Thank you very much. Thank you for all the hard work. Congratulations. Thank you for your years of service on PNC. And initiating this great project. I, as people know, travel for NACO. I see bike share programs everywhere. They had one in Long Beach when I was just there. They're just really springing up and expanding across the country, and it's something that I think our guests as well as our locals really appreciate.
Well, thank you all very much.
Thank you.
And we'll see you all
thank you
very
much.
Soon.
Okay.
Thanks.
I also had one small open discussion item to pass along to you, John. It's nothing major, but I have noticed that as you're leaving town at North Star, the pullout bridge, the bridge where everyone pulls out, probably because of all that activity, the road asphalt's up here and the dirt's down here, and it's become a really precipitous drop-off. I was actually receiving a phone call, so I was pulling over. Where's a good place to pull over to listen to that? And it was like, oh my gosh, don't pull over here. I got pretty close. I could almost practically imagine some cars turning over if they went down that side. It's just, and I don't know if that's Forest Service. I don't know how we go about building that back up. But right now, it's not a pothole. It's just become quite a ledge, probably a foot and a half at some spots.
Okay,
thank you. Did anyone else have any open discussion items? All right, well, let's take a look at the time. We are a little bit ahead, but we're going to take a 5-minute break, and then you guys can prep and get any slides or anything else up, and we'll come back for our airport update. Okay, so we're on break. Thank you, Grassroots. In 15 minutes early for this, we're kind of cutting right through that schedule today. And thank you, Grassroots. We're back on the air. All right. Anyone who's just tuning in now, it's Tuesday, August 16th, and it's about 3:45 in the afternoon. You've tuned into the Board of County Commissioners work session, and we're about to hear an airport update. So, John Kinney, and each of you as you speak, just introduce yourselves for the record and take it from here. Thank you.
Rachel, thank you. Good afternoon to the commission. My name is John Kinney, the airport director at Aspen-Pitkin County Airport. We've got some folks here with us today that we'll introduce in just a moment, but we have a PowerPoint presentation for you that we'd like to share on some of the different issues and discussion points with you. In a nutshell, it's about staffing, some organizational alignment, operational and financial indicators of what's happening at the airport, some of, in terms of some trends over the last few years. Also want to talk to you about safety and security, which obviously is first and foremost always in our mind as we operate that wonderful facility. Also talk to you a little bit about an emerging business acumen and some philosophies behind that. Then want to talk in a little bit about the facility, some of the environmental efforts that we have going on, and then what's next for the Aspen-Pitkin County Airport stakeholders and our community partners. So here's a org chart that's a little bit more complicated than it looks after you look at it for a few hours, but it really represents Ashley Wiles is the executive assistant stakeholder, and Ashley is here today with us, and she joined us about 6 months ago. A controller going left to right, the controller revenue position is chaired by an individual here, but I'll let him introduce himself and give him a little 15-second infomercial in terms of his background. So, Chris.
All right, my name is Chris Padilla. I'm the new controller out at the airport, and I have my background's in aerospace, and I've been in charge of a number of different accounts and account types, and I've really enjoyed it very much. But the airport industry is really where my heart is.
What part of the country did you come from?
I'm originally from Indiana. I went to move to Utah for school, and then now here, Colorado.
And John or Chris, this is a new position. We've never had this position before, as some other positions as you're going through this org chart.
Thank you. That's a great comment, George. So this is a new position. First time we've had a controller. We're doing a little bit of a deeper dive, and historically, we'll talk about some of the challenges maybe that we've had historically. I think people maybe were spread a little too thin and tried to do a variety of topics, and as the maturity curve developed at the airport and the complexity of issues grew, they weren't able to do the deepest dive as maybe as we needed to or could to or could have. So Chris is a brand new position, and he is going to be the new controller, first inaugural run, so he'll be doing a very deep dive with the assistance of Jennifer, who we'll introduce in just a moment, really into the revenue generation, revenue forecasting, and leases and RFPs and kind of the procurement process.
And George, just to recap, as we looked at reorganizing for the airport, we are also looking ahead. We probably have the biggest capital projects right now that we're going through an environmental assessment on that the county has taken on in its history. And so we wanted to be sure that we were building an organization that was prepared to manage and plan appropriately for those projects. So to John's point about building capacity, we've been trying to build more capacity and expertise, both to address where we are today, but more importantly, looking at the major projects we have on the horizon.
And so as we go forward with the airport proposed expansion, Chris will be in one of your roles will be in terms of being in contact with the FAA for potential grants and.
Correct. I'll be working with FAA and any other government agencies for grants and any kind of specific funds that have to be used for specific areas of the airport to keep us compliant.
Great.
And assisting Chris a whopping 6 hours after joining the organization is Jennifer Matchley, who just joined us from
She needs to come up to a microphone.
Okay.
I'm Jennifer Matchley. I just moved here from California. I had 12 years of accounting in California, but it's pretty much all the same in any state except for the different acronyms that you use at the airport and in the state. And I really have been here for only 6 hours.
Where are you in California?
San Diego County.
Okay. My neck of the woods.
Very good. Well, I'm glad you got here in time for the employee picnic.
Like this every day.
Yeah.
Just about.
And then also our director of security landside operations. I'd like to introduce Mike Yeft, Mike Yeft,
aka Mike Yeft. I just came on board approximately full-time 6 weeks ago. My background, 20 years of experience in airport security operations, Kansas City, New York, Denver, and parts of LA.
Thank you.
Welcome again.
Thank you.
And to my right, probably the newest individual at the airport, just a mere 28 years, Phil Mraz.
So I'm Phil Mraz. I've been there the last 24 years, to be exact, almost 28. So I'm heading up Director of Operations and Emergency Management. I've been involved with the past triannual drills. You probably see my face around there designing and actually performing them. But we look to enhance that part of our operations at the airport. So.
Well, welcome here for the long run. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank all of you for coming in.
Thanks. Well, I think we got a great team here. Chris didn't tell you, he came from the rocket industry, so he has some interesting stories of how that industry actually works and is funded, but another time. So today, in terms of the organizational alignments and function, what this chart does that we had shown to you probably about 10 months ago and you funded through the budgetary process, thank you, it's really migrating us towards less dependency on consultants. I think that's going to be about a three-year effort, and it's going to be topic-driven. It'll ebb and flow as we get into new topics and very heavy with some of the PFCs and the rates and fee methodologies and some of these other things. As staff gets up to speed with that, we'll wean ourselves very quickly from that of the consultant industry. So I think with the background that these folks have shared with you, they're more than capable and have the capacity to really take it to the next level, which we're excited about. But then simultaneously, we're also building a greater capacity through the progression and succession planning with the staff. So very much involving the staff really at the lowest level to be involved with a variety of things, because it's a relatively young staff underneath Phil and Mike, and we want to provide them every opportunity. So if they're interested in going on to another facility, then they got the background to do it. Because what's cool about a smaller facility like Aspen is you get involved with a lot of things, and it gives you kind of that breadth of knowledge that either makes you more marketable or increases job satisfaction. So moving ahead, the new arrivals we've talked about, we will be talking to you in the future about future FTE recruitments to address a little bit more in depth the contract leases, RFPs, grants, and PFCs. We've really got an age wave of contracts coming our way. We're going to have a tremendous amount of RFPs of probably about 20 or so in the next 24 months. It's almost going to be an average of one a month coming your way. In addition to that, there'll be security in terms of our TSA requirements and operational demands. That just continues to grow, and we'll talk a little bit more about that a little bit later. But security is definitely something we need to keep pace with. We have played catch up in a couple categories, whereas some other categories were very solid. But it's a changing dynamic and a changing animal, if you will. In terms of the operational and financial indicators out at the airport, you can see what our passenger enplanements are. So there's two descriptors. There's actually three that airports follow in terms of people coming and going to the airport. One is what your throughput is in terms of passengers at your security screening checkpoint. That determines your complexity in terms of category X through 4, 4 being the smallest, X being the largest, and we're a category 3. And there's also deplanements, and there's also inplanements. And so how we make our money is how many people are getting onto aircraft. And that's then what generates a head tax, called the PFC, the passenger facility charge. So we get $4.50 up to a total of three segments, $12.50 of revenue that comes to us based on where those passengers are flying. So that's a huge revenue source for us. So as you can see from 2015 over 14, there was a solid increase, 4.3, probably around the 2 to 3 around the country was the norm. And now we're a 5.4 increase on top of 2015 as we're tracking so far with 16. Check bags, you can see we're at nearly right about a quarter of a million bags that are being processed through the TSA, which is a indicator, and I believe we're up about how many percent, Chris?
6.4% from last year.
In terms of check bags, and that's really becoming a choke point for the Transportation Security Administration, and they're actually very interested in adding additional screening capacity in terms of machines, which is located behind the ticket counters. In terms of the jet fuel volume, that's also up, 12.7 increase over last year, which is a huge jump. And then general aviation in terms of the operations. So if you say, well, what's the relationship between 12.4 and 4.1? It just represents you got heavy drinkers coming into the airport, as we call them, and referring to the consumption of Jet A. Our operating and management budget, our maintenance budget, is in line with our forecast. In fact, we're tracking about $180,000 to the good. That does not include some of the security enhancements that we'll be bringing back to you at some point in time in the future. So as we talked about the airport, it's one of your probably most regulated pieces of property in your inventory, maybe the most, but if not, it's really near the top. So you have the Transportation Security Administration, you have the Federal Aviation Administration, which deals not only with air traffic control, which is the big aspect of the FAA, but it's also the FISDO, the Flight Standards District Office, and they certify pilots, aircraft, experimental aircraft, kit aircraft, pilots, as well as mechanics. And then you also have the navigational aids section for facilities, and then you also have the airports where we dabble in the most, and that's where it really drives the safety emergency management, the caliber of individuals that we have on the airfield, which is regulated and required, as well as training and equipment. And there's also 32 grant assurances that go with that. The 32 grant assurances have 25 federal legislative orders, acts that go with those, with 6 executive orders from the presidents, as well as federal regulations, to a total of 51 regulatory regulations. And if I brought those books into you, it would be far taller than me and even with someone on my shoulders. So a very voluminous, far-reaching component in terms of the grant assurances. You have the EPA for a variety of obvious reasons, State Aeronautics for planning, operation, maintenance, Division of Wildlife for mitigation so that we keep the operations safe, and the NTSB, who really does the accident investigation, as well as the Family Assistance Center, is that really a requirement of the airlines, but the airlines so often need the help of airports to put something like that together. So in the event of a crash, they anticipate 8 people coming for each passenger. So if you had a 70-passenger aircraft, you'd have at least pushing 600 people coming into the town. And the airlines, what they usually do, the last time an airline, a foreign carrier, came in, they usually buy the hotels out and then just work it. So those people who have injured loved ones or deceased loved ones are accommodated appropriately. They spent $16 million. The Asiana crash in San Francisco, they spent over 50 because the town was sold out and they had to get the Family Assistance Center. So it's a critical aspect, but it can be a very challenging aspect, but it's the airline's responsibility, but not ours, but we definitely have a big role in it. And we're looking forward to working closer with the chamber and the hoteliers to talk more about that contingency planning in the future. In terms of the safety and security, continuing with that, the primary threat in terms of the TSA is the insider threat. You've seen a variety of situations take place across the country where people have been smuggling dozens of guns. At one time, there was 27 guns fully loaded in an overhead baggage compartment going from Atlanta to New York. And it was an insider threat that I would show up to the airport. Mike would be an inside employee, would switch the bag. He'd take it down, load it onto the aircraft. I'd go get on the aircraft. And there's dozens of unfortunate examples like that. So the insider threat is very, very concerning to the TSA. They've had a variety of new protocols for us to be following. It's very particularly concerning to us that we make sure that we keep pace with our security efforts at that airport with our major partners such as LAX, San Francisco, Chicago O'Hare, DFW, Denver, Salt Lake, Atlanta. You think about what we are. We are part of a global system. We're one stop away from going anywhere in the world. We're one stop away from Tel Aviv. We're one stop away from any corner of the world. So security is really not a convenience, but it's something that we need to make sure that we keep a very sharp, focused edge on. And there's really no opt-outs. So we've been working very closely with the community out there in security. And now that we have Mike Yaft here, who's really doing a deep dive in security, we're bringing some things up to speed that definitely need to be so. And
yeah, I'm just going to say that I agree that the global system as far as security, but and there may be no opt-outs, but by past history, when an issue comes up that doesn't fit with small rural airports because of our capacity issues or our proximity to our sheriff's department, we have been known to change those rules so they better fit our needs in rural communities. So if something were to come up that we just couldn't grasp or we couldn't deal with, it's not unlike this Board of County Commissioners to take that at hand and help to better serve the airport. So you know that we're always here to help you guys out.
Good to know.
You were here when we did that.
Thank you. In terms of continuing with the safety and security, Part 139, that's our certification that allows us to have scheduled service. We're 47th busiest in the country, as we talked, I think, a couple meetings ago, but worth re-mentioning is the staff accomplishment of the zero discrepancies for the Part 139. There was a couple items that came out. One was the chain link fence approach that the FAA would like to see in terms of keeping the wildlife, specifically the bears, off the airfield. And then also de-ice pad lighting. So when the trucks go out to de-ice the aircraft during the nighttime hours and the early morning hours, visibility is a critical factor. And right now we don't meet that standard. So we're looking at light poles and putting that through the process of how do we illuminate the area and do it in such a way that it maintains safety, but also maintains a community compatibility. We are also recognized for outstanding snow and ice control this year, which is also a great staff accomplishment, which we're pretty proud of. And the emergency management in terms of the response, recovery, and resiliency, along with the event of social media and managing that family assistance center, those are really going to be some focus points for us in 2016 and 2017. The good news is we don't get a lot of events. The bad news is we don't get a lot of practice. And it's a very perishable skill, these categories. So we're going to find a variety of creative ways and engaging the whole community to make sure that we're resilient through having very solid response and recovery plans.
John, I'd imagine you'd be talking with Pat Bingham about her efforts as our PI officer in the county.
Absolutely. Pat Bingham, as well as Chief Ballantyne and Valerie. With emergency management, absolutely, yeah, because we're going to need help at the airport, lots of it.
Steve, any question on this point?
John, when you say Aspen is ranked 47th out of 533, does that mean in terms of security breaches or testing or the volume, or what is the 47th?
Volume, I'm sorry, volume. So in terms of passengers.
Volume of passengers.
You know, let me pull back just for a second on that, Steve. Actually, that can't be the case. That must be 147, so I apologize for that.
147?
Right.
147th out of 533, though.
Correct.
So it's one of the busiest airports in the whole United States.
Of our size.
It's definitely getting up there. You're in the upper half, no doubt about it. And if you have a couple more years of the growth that you have, you'll actually go into a new classification of small hub airport. Mm-hmm. No, it's small hub, medium, and large. That's it. So it's getting busy. In terms of some of the emerging challenges, as we talk about the business acumen out at the airport and our need to really refine and focus, a couple challenges: the federal and state grants are rapidly declining. We've been very successful to date and historically, prior to my arrival for sure, of securing grants, which has been great, but those are declining. But we are well positioned for the upcoming CIP projects that John was talking about earlier. But the PFC is stuck at a rather anemic $4.50. If you look at what bag fees have done over the same 12-year period of time, they've gone from zero into the billions for airline revenues. You take into account inflation's at $2.85 purchasing power today. That's pretty anemic from the $4.50 that you're collecting. So there's a variety of discussions of, can we change the financing mechanisms and the bonding capabilities of airports so that they can go more about it towards revenue bonds. There's a variety of folks far smarter than me in the financial world who are trying to position themselves, and the FAA is listening, because the airlines have been very, very successful at shutting airports down in terms of them getting a greater than $4.50 PFC. So that'll be an interesting issue for us to watch in the coming 2 to 3 years. Also churning, a lot of airports are to non-aeronautical revenues because you make more money than you do from the airlines, which is really the aviation, a national utility. We have some opportunities for that, but somewhat limited, but then again, we do have some. Also, we're taking a look at our existing revenues to ensure that our rates are reflective of the opportunities that people are coming into the airport, but also at the same time preserving and stimulating the market, so not overly charging and damaging it. We're very interested in proactive forecasting towards those revenue opportunities and creating metrics to really track how we're doing out there in a very proactive way. I think historically we were a little bit of challenged, as we talked about a little bit earlier, kind of that age wave of things coming up all at once, and now repositioning our subject matter experts for a little bit of a deeper dive. But I think you might be receiving some of the contacts in regards to this, because some of those leases have been expired, and I think they might have a little bit of a sticker shock on a few of those if they've gone month to month. And so we'll definitely communicate with the folks and let them know where we are, where we're going, why we're going where we're going, but just simply paying very close attention to the business component, you might receive some a little bit of sticker shock from some folks who maybe have been paying some older rates, or some as the leases are renegotiated, the newer rates, because some were 10, 15 years old, one's pushing 30 years old. So in terms of the business opportunities, these are some of the RFPs that are coming up. You have the restaurant lease. We've actually gone into a month-to-month because we are not able to get it done in time during the peak season. But we have two retail spaces, a cafe area, as well as an opportunity for folks to have carts if they want to come out in the ticketing area, which folks have been interested in seeing, or the baggage claim area. So there's a variety of opportunities, and as we're starting to get the word out, there seems to be quite a bit of local interest in bidding on this. So we'll see how that turns out. We'll probably launch the RFP right around the January timeframe, get through the peak season, and then hopefully be able to award it in April and get someone in there during the May timeframe on the shoulder season. Parking concession, really think that's an opportunity for us. We spend a tremendous amount of time, staff, just working through that. People calling with the tickets, they lost their ticket doesn't work. Could they come out and help us? If we spent a small percentage of our revenues, which are right about 400 and Chris?
480,000 for 2015.
For 2015, we sent a small percentage of that and privatized that, had a vendor come in and operate that, as well as take a look at where we are in terms of rates and fees. I think you could almost have it cost neutral and create that greater capacity with staff on the passenger experience, terminal, airfield, and security issues. So that's something we're going to take a hard look at, and we'll keep you posted. Rental car concessions are going to be coming up in 2017, as well as putting an RFP out for the terminal design team, if you so approve it through the EA process. Planning services contract will be expiring. Yes, sir.
On the rental car concessions, is there a way that you can prioritize or incentivize the rental companies to utilize electric
sure.
cars?
You bet.
I'd like to see how we can move that forward. And I'm sure the city of Aspen would love to see that move forward as well.
Mm-hmm. George, would we have to put in charging stations in at the rental car facilities?
Well, we have charging stations in the city, and we talked about having a charging station out at the airport.
I don't think it's a stopping point, but it may be at a certain amount of volume. How many cars can get in there, and will we see the charging stations all being used up by airport rental cars as opposed to citizens being able to get in? So it might be a matter of magnitude, and, you know,
it's a discussion.
If it'd be acceptable to you, I would say electric cars or hybrids. Because you know, if they were doing more Toyota Priuses or even the SUVs, which are popular out here, and they were doing a hybrid SUV, it'd still be better for the airport.
Yeah, and it would be as we're planning for the future airport terminal, which is years away still. But this would be sort of a lead in terms of planning to address that we need more charging stations to if we want to really try to. Encourage car companies to go to EVs versus gas.
And so I think what we can do when we get to that point is bring back an assessment for the board to consider, you know, what kind of capital investments might be required to support, you know, a certain goal and take it from there.
And certain amount of capacity for charging. Right. But that's a great idea, George. I think that's good. We're at the time frame where we should be thinking ahead that way.
Also emerging in 2017 will be the planning as well as the engineering services contract. There's a cell tower leased within the airport operations center that the existing operator was very interested in having that go back out to lease so they can secure it for a longer period of time. We don't quite fully understand that, but we will get to we'll flush those issues out, but that's an opportunity for some potential additional revenue. And then the terminal building advertising lease. I think it's an opportunity for us to balance out the advertising with the community and local artists through an emerging art program. But right now that lease goes until 2019, the summer of 2019. So, there's been a fair amount of discussion on that historically. We simply wanted to list this to make you realize that we have it on our radar.
If we could bring that in any sooner, that would be great. Incentivize them to renegotiate.
We're in discussions with them right now to see what opportunities we have, and we'll definitely keep you posted on
Thank
that.
Thank you.
In terms of the environmental efforts that we have going at the airport, one is the Canary Initiative led by the City of Aspen. It is updated metrics now, which we think are more of a sustainable parameters for the airport. Historically, they were looking at metrics where if an aircraft left here and flew all the way to Switzerland, we would get credit for it the entire length to Switzerland. And if it flew around Europe, we would still get that credit. So. We've kind of got them to refocus on what we can manage and what we can't manage because people wanted to change the curfews, extend the curfews, tighten it down further, restrictions on louder aircraft, mandate percentages of biofuel. So we had some discussions about what do we have control over versus federal preemption. So what we've come up with is the new industry standard emerges from the FAA and the EPA, where it's point-to-point calculations inside the which is basically either here to the east or west coast, as opposed all the way to Europe. And it's new focus on what we can manage. So I think it's a little bit more of a manageable component. And then the big effort for us right now is the environmental assessment. And so in case some folks are listening to this that have not heard some of the items, we thought would wrap quite a bit of context around this. So I appreciate the time to do this. But I sent out as PowerPoint, it was listed as September, I believe 15th was the next meeting. That needs to be changed for a variety of folks being out of town. So it looks like either September 22nd or 29th. So mid to end of September, we still will get a month's notice out to the community is when we'll have our next community input committee, as well as our community workshop. And the primary focus of that will be the terminal massing, taking a look at the 25% design, really slick superimposing views from the Buttermilk, from the Starwood, coming up 82, coming down 82, and what's the visual impact. So I think people will really start to see some substantive discussions moving ahead with that. But in terms of the environmental assessment and where we are, originally Aspen Airport did an airport master plan back in 2012, and the FAA accepted the master plan along with the ALP, which is an acronym for Airport Layout Plan. It's basically a graphical depiction of what you plan conceptually to build over the next 20 to 30 years, and do you have a capital plan to meet that. So those were put in, and it called for a continuation of our modification to standard, the separation between the runway and the taxiway, and that was at 320 feet, and today's design standard is 400 feet. So the FAA said we accept everything with the exception of that continuation of that modification to standard, and we really want to see you move the runway over 80 feet, meet the full standard. That would allow then full Group 3 design aircraft to come into the airport. So it would allow the larger RJs, and would it allow larger aircraft? We still don't know for sure, and that's what's going to be flushed out in the environmental assessment process. But a significant point to that is that the original assumption for the 70-passenger regional jet in the master plan then yielded, based on those volumes, a 96,000 square foot terminal building. Subsequently, that was reduced to 80,000 square feet in terms of a master plan, and this is really, as I understand it and everything that I have seen, the community's baseline, the terminal building being 80,000 square feet. But the footnote here is that the next generation of regional jets go all the way up to 135 passenger size seating capacity, but they're still regional jets, smaller than that of the 737, but close to the same capacity. That will impact the peak passenger hourly flow rates from the original ones that was contained in the airport master plan. That will have an influence on the functionality of the terminal building. So I think that that will continue to be a discussion point that will be started in the next month or two with the community. So after we get through this environmental phase, the next phase is the terminal design, if we move that forward. In the terminal design phase, which is after the EA, the terminal facility will be reflective of the customer experience, the operational needs, yet balanced with the community's expectations. So as we said, major discussion point. And then the terminal size will not be determined or committed in the EA. It's only a space reservation to clear the footprint environmentally. It's the next public phase, which is the terminal design, that really will get into how big is the checkpoint, how big are the administrative offices, how big are the airline operating areas, how big is the TSA bag area for screening. But that'll be a very transparent process, very much a dissection. But even then, after we go through that terminal process and bring back to you a set of plans and drawings, it's not go, no-go decision point at that time. That is only if you and when you accept the grant does that then put that into motion. So there's still several more trigger points for the BOCC that documents will be brought forward to you and heavy community involvement.
Okay. Rachel?
Yeah, Patty?
You know, I'm very concerned about this potential larger seating capacity on the next generation planes, jets. And I think we'll have some concerns brought forward. My feeling is from the community that, well, if they're going to be larger seating capacity on the planes, we'll need less planes. And the issue would be, but if you have four of those planes come in at one time, you've got, so I think we'll have to look at the scheduling issues, because my gut feeling is we're not going to want a community to build 120,000 square foot terminal, because we may have four planes come in once a day. They probably would rather look at fewer planes, larger capacity, but not all of those planes coming in at the same time. I think you've already probably heard that, but just when I read this last night, I went, whoa, where did that, that's a big difference in numbers. And
point.
The community will be heard on that one, I can tell you that. Loud and clear.
But, and that, I think, is the point of us calling out, that's got to be a conversation.
Oh, yeah.
We've got a lot of balance points that we're going to need to meet in that conversation. But I think, you know, to talk arbitrarily about a square foot number high or low doesn't make sense until we have that conversation about what is the experience that we want our customers and our community to have. And then how does that relate to yeah. design? And that, I think, makes more sense because we tend to get stuck on a square footage number. It doesn't make a whole
yeah,
lot
think,
of sense
outside
that context.
I think we'll have to
context.
Look at the opportunities we have to address the number issue when we know more about the numbers. And I'm not talking the square, well, I'm talking the square footage
right.
also, but the seating capacity when we have a better feel for what really is coming out, because it's kind of yep. been a moving target. But and I think the community will be part of that to say, we can agree to X, but this is, we also need to have Y brought in. So you knowing this community, as I think we all do, that discussion will be had
yeah.
over and over.
Yeah.
Steve?
Yeah, we have to keep in mind that a lot of the planes coming in now are continuing on to another destination. So they're going from, I don't know where the routes are, but say they start in the West Coast and they're ending up on the East Coast somewhere with us being a midway stop. So there, some of those passengers are not staying in Aspen, but they would get off the airplane and be in the terminal and then get back on the plane and continue on. So.
You mean when there's kind of a layover and a refuel?
Yeah, so getting a handle on those kind of numbers, I think, would be important for what we need to plan for in the airport.
Thank you. Please, John, continue.
Thank you. And really our next slide, and I do believe the last slide, is what's next for the airport in terms of the stakeholders and the community partners? I think really everyone's desired outcome of the EA is achieve that environmental community compatibility, sizing the terminal to achieve functionality and sustainable air service, but compatible with the community. In terms of balancing improvements with the life cycle of the existing terminal, short term, TSA and the airlines would really like to see improvements at the facility. The TSA specifically would like to bring in 1 to 2 more CTX, which is basically the CAT scans of baggage, if you will, based on the volumes that they are not bringing in. Presently right now, up to 400 bags a week are not making it onto flights because they cannot be processed through the TSA checkpoint in time. So the experience of going out of Aspen during the peak periods can be a little challenging. The airline's perspective is if you increase the TSA baggage screening area, they are then going to have the capacity to overrun our baggage makeup area. So after the bags go to the ticket counter and then go to the TSA, they then go out back to the airline's custody and then they sort them based on the destination. And the process to do that, whether flights are delayed or canceled, they have to take bags off and start stacking them places. So they need space beyond the conveyor belt system. So to balance those two, that has a direct relationship. So the TSA is proposing increased staffing as well as the machines. They pay for that. The airlines are looking at for us to find some solutions for increasing their baggage makeup area out there on the ramp before they load them onto the carts. And then they would be charged through the rate and fee process for us to recoup the cost associated with that. So we're in discussions right now. What are options? What are realistic? First numbers started at $6 million, then $4 million, then $3 million, and $1.5 million. I said, let's get that even in half of that. So we're in process now that's just an evolution of discussion, trying to be creative. So we'll keep you posted on that and see how we can bring that back to you with minimal capital investment, but at the same time addressing some of their ergonomic issues because they are having increased worker comp injuries with TSA specifically and to some extent the airlines. It's pretty rough operating conditions for them to pick the bags up, dodge some support pulls that are structural, and then put them back down in the system. It's one of the few manual systems still left in the country. Most, you put it on, you don't touch it again unless it's an alarm.
You know, it's, I think, frustrating for all of us.
knowing that the true construction of a new terminal and the new amenities is multiple years out, you know, three, four, who knows. Yet at the same time, we need to keep as high a customer service and functioning airport today as possible. So as you said, it's not like we want to throw good money after bad and just see it wasted. But on the other hand, we can't allow things to fall apart in terms of service before then. You know, and it really strikes me, I know we started this project a while ago with Jim Elwood before you came on, John, but it's very timely that we've been trying to move it forward as quickly as it can. It's almost like a big water project in terms of the time and the permitting and the outreach and things going forward. So it's good that we're going to be in a good position, but we just have to mind the gaps, as it were, as we get there. And so appreciate that you're looking out for those dollar numbers as well and pulling in the partners who appropriately should be helping us out in terms of that system. The other thing I think to keep in the back of our minds while you're trying to solve the short-term issue is anything reusable or would have a resale value to others or something like that, so that we can, you know, maximize the value of the investments we do have to make. And from my talking to John Peacock about it, you know, while you know, like to have something that's fully automated and going, the requirements, the physical requirements there of potentially more roof space and tenting it, the cost of the equipment itself, and would we be in shape in time for Christmas week? And, you know, if we have to look to potential additional manual labor assistance in that level or how we have to do it. But we need to keep it moving effectively. And I think people are sometimes more concerned when they get here without their gear to go skiing. But when you get home and you don't have, you know, all your kids' clothes or things like that, it can be certainly problematic waiting for that delivery. So, George.
Yeah, and it's timely. I just wonder how you work with all the music students who are leaving. You know, some have already left, some are leaving all during this next week as the festival winds down. And so they're traveling with cellos and
tubas
and sousaphones and... How do you deal with
it? Just be grateful they're not traveling with their pianos.
Yeah. It does make it challenging.
Yeah, because you just can't throw that stuff on the conveyor belt, right?
They're pretty mindful of what goes through. And I would say out of the variety of airports that I've worked at, when I was with TSA, I oversaw six airports and three were of this size. This is the best TSA crew I've ever seen. Yeah, they really care. They're invested in the community. A lot of them live here, and
it's true.
It's a very top-notch crew, but that we have here in TSA.
Very good.
Can I just real quick? Do we have any footprint capacity at either? And you know, we also have an issue with baggage coming in that gets stuck there when it comes in by bus or something, and there's not a lot of security at that end. But do we have footprint capacity at the Down Valley end? I never know if it's north, south, east, or west. I don't think anybody does. Where we could actually give more capacity to the baggage that's being screened coming, that's going out, not coming in. Do we have a footprint capacity opportunities at that end?
I think you do on both ends. It's a little bit more luxurious, if you will, from a spatial standpoint. On the baggage claim area, would be easier to modify.
Yeah, there's kind of unaware the dumpsters used to be many years ago. I'm sure Phil remembers.
Well, and some of the things we're talking about, Patty, is taking the CTX machines, if they're oriented towards Owl Creek Road, turning 90 degrees to parallel Highway 82, and you could actually fit another machine in that building by simply just cutting a hole in the wall to let the conveyor belt go through. So we're finding some very simplistic
creativity out there.
Approaches.
Yeah, and but the thing that John and I talk about a lot is trying to have the solution that works, but not investing too much into a building that we're talking to the community about replacing in the next few years. And it's a difficult balance point, but I think that discussion's moving forward. And you know, whenever we talk about roof space, that those numbers go up pretty quickly in our community, of course. So
I'm thinking simple roofs.
Well, and we're thinking, you know, it could be it could be a temporary structure and those sorts of things.
Temporary structures. So. I agree. But it's something I think we need to look at.
Okay, so that concludes your presentation, John?
It does.
This was great.
Other board member questions or comments at this time?
I guess I'm not seeing any.
This is very thorough. We appreciate it. And everyone, again, taking the time coming in. And we'll be working closely with you on so many things going forward. This won't be the last chat. So appreciate that very much. And again, nothing else from the other board members. You guys can leave, and we'll finish up our agenda.
Very
I don't
good.
Think we have too much
Thank
else
you.
Left.
Thank
yeah,
welcome
thanks.
On board.
Got you out a half hour early. That's always.
Coming in.
Thanks again. Appreciate that. Okay.
Here we have it.
Let's see. I'm trying to think if there were any other small items. Did anybody else have any open discussion items or things that have come up during the meeting? I did have one small one for you, John. I'm glad. I think it was George mentioning the electric cars at the airport that reminded me. This past weekend, I was returning a car or picking up a car out at the Public Works, and I noticed that of the new electric charging stations, 3 out of 4 were parked up with our electric cars, and one of them was charging, but the other two weren't. And it just struck me that if members of the public were trying to use the charging station over the weekend, we shouldn't be parking our cars at the charging stations. They should charge up and then be moved to another spot.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Just kind of pass that along. And that's all. So again, thank you. And you're waiting for Big John to lead the way. He makes a heck of a Santa Claus, too, if you guys haven't seen that before. Well,
there are children listening.
Santa Claus
there are children listening to this meeting? Are you, maybe yours.
Okay. If there's nothing else from anyone, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All right. Second?
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Great. We're adjourned. Thank you. Thank you, Grassroots.
We don't need-